Okay. These communications never work well.
Good evening, everyone. I'd like to welcome you to the City of Warrenville City Council regular meeting for March 20th, 2017. May I have a roll call, please?
Alderman Ashower?
Here.
Alderman Berry?
Here.
Alderman Bevere?
Here.
Alderman Davalos?
Here.
Alderman Goodman?
Here.
Alderman Hoffman?
Here.
Alderman Widener?
Here.
Alderman Wilson?
Here.
I don't even have to speak. You guys know what we're going to do. I love it. Would you please stand as you're able and join me for the Pledge of Allegiance?
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you. We're going to start off our meeting this evening with a fiscal year 2018 budget presentation by the Community Development Department, specifically our Community Development Director. Ron Metzer will make the presentation. Welcome, Ron.
Thank you, Mayor and City Council. I do appreciate this opportunity to make this annual presentation to you on the department's budget proposal for next year. Enhance the city's tax base, support the growth of business, increase local shopping and dining opportunities, diversify the city's labor market, expand housing options, and create attractive gathering places. I would hope that those are still very important things for the City Council and expectations that the City Council has for the Community Development Department to continue to work on advancing. Yes? That's good. That's very good, because when you combine those statements, those really are the core and only goal that's established in the city's relatively new economic development plan. In addition to that, those are the types of things that when we sit down to develop our work program each year and our budget proposal for the City Council, that we reflect back on these important policy documents, these important goals, and we identify what we think we can do to help advance those goals. So hopefully, through my presentation, you'll see some dovetailing of these statements with the various accomplishments and for fiscal year 2017 and our goals for next fiscal year. Three things I want to cover are talk about what we've accomplished for the community in 2017, fiscal year 2017, what we expect to accomplish for the community next fiscal year, and then conclude with talking just briefly about a few things that I see are challenges that we'll be dealing with this year and probably moving forward. I'm going to start with talking about operational and customer service accomplishments, and specifically the reorganization and full staffing of the Community Development Department. This is really important because this specific accomplishment, I believe, has laid the foundation for many of the other accomplishments I'm going to talk about this evening, and puts the city in a good position to achieve the various goals that are identified in the proposed budget and work program that you have from the Community Development Department for next year. It was about 2 years ago we were in the process of finalizing the city's first economic development plan. Not only did that plan identify the overall goal I just spoke of, but it identified 8 specific objectives that the city needed to move forward and advance in order to achieve that goal, best position itself. One of those objectives was to figure out how we were going to allocate more resources so that we could proactively start implementing various economic development initiatives. As a follow-up to that adoption of the plan by the City Council, staff made a variety of recommendations to the City Council. For tonight's meeting, I want to focus on 2 of those recommendations because it dovetails with the reorganization and staffing of the Community Development Department. And that was to change the structure of the Community Development Department, which at that time, and had been a really flat organizational structure, where 7 of the full-time staff members reported directly to the Community Development Director, and the Community Development Director was responsible for the day-to-day operations of the Building and Code Enforcement Division. We recommended that structure change be more pyramidal, have three division heads that would be responsible for the various divisions in the department. The frontline staff would report to those people. The community development director would obviously oversee the department, but would be ideally have more time to spend on economic development initiatives. The second recommendation was to have one of those division heads, a new position, the chief code official position, that would be responsible for the day-to-day operations of the building and code enforcement division. Council approved those. We ultimately moved forward and implemented those. Our first chief code official position or staff member was hired about a year ago. At the beginning of this current fiscal year, we hired the city's last full-time staff members to kind of fill the gaps that had evolved over the last year. Christine was one of those people, and a full-time combined building inspector position, code enforcement officer. Those changes have allowed us to effectively deal with the increased permit and inspection volume that we continue to experience. In 2016, we issued 619 building permits out of the Community Development Department and conducted approximately 2,000 inspections. This fiscal year, we're projecting that we'll issue somewhere in the neighborhood of 640, 650 building permits and coordinate 2,400, 2,500 inspections. Both of those are records for the city. We've never experienced that level of building permit activity or inspection activity in the past. And certainly we've been able to accomplish that in part because of these structural modifications that were made in the department and the staffing adjustments. And at the same time, we were able to reduce this current fiscal year the amount of money that the department allocates and spends on outside building permit review, inspection, and code enforcement consulting assistance by about half. So I think that's another benefit that we've been able to achieve this year. A couple other notable, somewhat unrelated customer service improvements that I wanted to touch on is at the last Community Development Committee meeting, Natalia Domovasova, our senior planner, presented to the City Council what we've been able to accomplish with the implementation of the first phase of the GIS plan. She gave a demonstration of the information that's now available on the city's website to the public. I think that's been a nice customer service enhancement. And we've developed and implemented an electronic building permit application system so that people no longer have to come into the office to apply for their building permit. They still have to come in and get it if it gets approved, but they can apply electronically, digitally. So that's a nice improvement. Certainly those structural modifications to the staffing and organization of the department have allowed me and our department to spend more time and effort on proactive economic development efforts. This last year, we've done a lot to kind of reinforce and build the foundation for desirable economic development in the community. It started early in the year with the City Council's unanimous adoption of the Southwest District Subarea Plan. Continued in the fall when the City Council approved the city's fourth TIF district, which encompasses or covers about 300 acres in the Southwest District area of our community that has been fairly stagnant for the better part of three decades, somewhat underperforming for the community. Earlier this year, we started working with a consultant to further define and establish what the city's brand, what we're going to try to promote ourselves, what's special about Warrenville, why should businesses and residents be attracted to Warrenville, so we want to market that more effectively going forward. We've developed a detailed policy on how the city would process and look at potential TIF assistance requests. That was discussed in some detail at the last Community Development Committee meeting. It's actually on tonight's City Council agenda for hopefully an endorsement. That will support informed decision-making from the council going forward. And finally, I'm not going to go into any detail on it. You know the details. We've been talking about it, but we've done a lot of work to advance and prepare for like $6 million worth of new, very necessary, high-quality public infrastructure being constructed in the community this year to support new economic development activities in the community. So what are the results of the past and current economic development investments we've made? Well, Chuy's has committed to building a new full-service restaurant out in the Cantera area, specifically on the unused portion of the Suburban G Regal Theater complex. That project's underway. Two Brothers has made a huge commitment to the Southwest District area of our community. They've actually gone out and purchased 20 acres of property located at the northwest corner of Route 59, Route 56, with the full intent of building a new state-of-the-art corporate complex for their ever-expanding business enterprises in the near-term future. And a big reason of that, and I can tell you, and if you ask them, is because of all the efforts the city has made to kind of promote positive economic development out in the Route 56, Route 59 area. In addition, just recently, earlier this year, a well-capitalized, experienced developer has been able to kind of pry Cantera subarea, Cantera Lot C2. It's a vacant 28-acre parcel out from underneath the grips of BP. It's located at the northeast, northwest corner of Winfield Road and Ferry Road, back behind the 8-story office building. It's a fallow piece of property that hasn't really provided much benefits for the community since BP owned it for the last 15 years, but now there's a developer that's actively working with the community to do a very high quality, extensive mixed use project. If you're interested in that, the Plan Commission will be conducting a courtesy review on that. That proposal is coming Thursday. And then finally, last but not least, is the amount of residential development that we continue to experience in the community. Last year, we issued permits for 36 new attached and detached single family homes. This year, we're projecting that we're going to issue permits for 35 or 36 new homes again. In total, each year, we're talking about $16 to $18 million worth of new residential market value construction that's occurred in the last 2 years in the community. And we don't see that trend diminishing going forward. Quality of life enhancements that we've helped advance this year as we worked with collaboratively with DuPage County to finalize the implementation and the construction of the DuPage River remeandering and bridge reconstruction projects. Those have had those projects together definitely have some positive benefits from the city from a flood mitigation standpoint. There was also some pretty extensive and very desirable improvements that were made to the Leon Schmidt Heritage Park, Warrenville Tavern, Warrenville Historical Museum properties. That I think the community will enjoy for years going forward. In addition, there was some pretty desirable pedestrian and path improvements that were made in and around those projects. A couple other trail improvement projects that we've been able to advance this past year that I think are worth noting. About this time last year, the City Council endorsed a conceptual plan for a potential trailhead improvement project on the Illinois Prairie Path out in front of City Hall. Staff took that conceptual plan, worked with the Illinois Prairie Path Association, DuPage County, and submitted a application for surface transportation funding. We were notified late last year that application was approved, and we've been awarded $378,000 worth of funding that can be used towards the construction of that project should the City Council ultimately determine that we are going to move forward with the construction of that project. And secondly, we've been actively working with DuPage County Forest Preserve District, Winfield Township, and an outside consulting firm to evaluate in some detail the various alternatives that are available for installing some new trail, pedestrian, bikeway improvements along that section of Mack Road that extends on the east from the McKee Marsh parking area all the way to Fox Hollow on the west. It would include some potential intersection improvements at Route 59. We'll be presenting the outcome of that alternatives analysis to the City Council in the coming months. Looking forward to next year, some of the operational enhancements that we're looking, customer service enhancements that we are committed to advancing is implementing the second phase of the GIS plan that will involve city staff working closely with the Public Works Department and an outside consulting firm to develop the organizational structure databases that will then be populated with all the detailed data for all of the extensive amount of underground city sanitary sewer and water main improvements that are located throughout the community so we can manage those improvements more effectively going forward. We're certainly going to be working closely with the finance department on the implementation of the ERP, the Enterprise Resource Planning Systems, that we're out to bid at this point in time. That's a huge undertaking for all of the departments in the community. The community development's component of that would involve hopefully some element of an electronic building permit software system. Code enforcement software system will dovetail with the financial aspect of those programs to help finalize a transition in the department from a paper-based system that existed forever now to a more current electronic system. Our chief code official is actively and diligently working on developing a comprehensive set of proposed recommendations that will be presented to the City Council early next year on the potential adoption of current building and fire codes for the community. The codes that we have in place are at least 10 years old, and we have a mishmash of amendments that in some cases are no longer necessary because of the current codes address those issues. In some cases don't necessarily mesh well with current technologies and common day building construction practices. So those will be presented to the City Council in anticipation of a wave of new development that we're expecting to happen in our community. And we want to get the new codes in place before that all happens. And then finally, last but not least, from an operational standpoint, is for the last 5 or 6 years, the Community Development Department has had something in the budget that relates to advancing this concept of a potential mandatory rental registration crime-free housing program. It would be a fairly large new program. We're talking about probably 12 to 1,500 structures, units that would be subject to this program. And the reality is we just haven't been comfortable in advancing that based on the staffing levels that we had in place, the other priorities that the City Council had established, and the structure of the Community Development Department. What we are committed to and we are comfortable this fiscal year, fiscal year 2018 advancing, is to helping support a detailed evaluation of the pros and cons of that type of program, the costs and benefits, so that the City Council can have a detailed, informed discussion of whether that makes sense for the community and how that might make sense for the community, make some decisions that we can then appropriately budget for if we're going to actually try to implement part or all that program in future fiscal years. Somebody else turned the page, so is that a hint? No? Okay, economic development. Some of the other important goals next year that we'll be working on is some further preparation for positive economic development in our community. We purchased the 8 acres of property. We assembled a bunch of properties at the northeast corner of 59 and 56 this last calendar year, last fiscal year. We have a decision package in the budget that would set aside funding that would allow us to hire an outside real estate brokerage marketing firm to help us properly market and position that property and then evaluate potential development purchase proposals that we might receive for that property this coming fiscal year. We acquired 5 acres of property along the west side of Route 59, just north of the Illinois Prairie Path through a charitable donation this past fiscal year. We call it, refer to that area as generally the Tortolella property. It's got some environmental floodplain wetland issues on it. We're currently evaluating those constraints and what type of opportunities that property might afford the city for helping to facilitate economic development out in that area of the community and some potential quality of life enhancements that might be attractive to future residents in that area of our community. So what we've developed is a decision package to set aside some funding that would allow us to move forward with the actual final design documents for potential improvements that the city might want to make to that property in the coming year. In the coming years, we can develop those final engineering documents this coming year. And then again, infrastructure. We continue to position ourselves to facilitate the construction, design construction of a lot of high quality, very necessary public infrastructure in the community. I think there's like $1.7 million worth of total decision packages that would encompass the property acquisition, the final engineering design, and the actual construction of a lot of this public infrastructure that we hope to see happen this coming construction year. What does this all support? These are some of the more important, most likely anticipated projects that we're going to be dealing with this coming fiscal year. I'm not going to talk about specifics, but collectively these projects involve 90 acres of property in the city of Warrenville, the highest and most desirable, largest redevelopment or development opportunity sites that we still have remaining in our community. Collectively, if those properties all develop as it's currently envisioned, we're talking about hundreds of millions of dollars worth of new private investment and development in the community. All of those properties are currently either under contract in some form or another, or have been purchased by developers that have experience and have the desire and commitment to actually get development going on these properties sooner than later, and are in some stage of the city's review and development entitlement process. Quality of life enhancements this coming year. We've developed decision packages for those that would help advance those four specific projects. The construction of the final phase of the Route 56 streetscape enhancement projects, the decision package that's in your fiscal 18 budget would cover the city's share of the costs. The bulk of the costs are covered by a grant that we received like 7 years ago from the state of Illinois, but the decision package would cover our share of the cost. We have a decision package that would allow us to move forward with the preliminary design documents for the proposed trailhead improvement project. We have a decision package that would cover the costs for the final engineering design design costs for the proposed Mack Road Trail Improvement Project that I talked about earlier. And then finally, last but not least, you all know that we have been actively talking and discussing, negotiating with the current owners of the now closed Citgo gas station property. We've developed a decision package that could lead to the city's purchase and redevelopment of that property if ultimately the city council decides that makes sense from a environmental liability standpoint and from a financial standpoint. Brings me to, in closing here, what I see some of the key challenges that we're going to be dealing with this fiscal year and going forward. We talked about a lot of economic development projects. They're really on the cusp of moving forward. These projects, in many cases, are very complex projects and will require a lot of city interaction to make sure that if they do actually get implemented, that they are reflective of the plans, goals, and objectives that we've adopted as a community and their high-quality projects. What I see happening, well, in total, there's like, we're expecting or projecting like $50 million worth of new building permit value construction this coming fiscal year. That's more than double than what we're projecting we will see this fiscal year, and it's more than double than what we experienced last fiscal year. What we see happening because of our relatively small building and code enforcement division, the chief code official, and one full-time building code enforcement officer position, that there's going to be a challenge to properly and efficiently handle all of that new construction permit activity and still respond effectively to code enforcement complaints that we receive. So what we have done is we've incorporated some funding in the proposed budget that allows us to tap back into those consulting resources if we need to bring in some outside help to fill that code enforcement gap if one starts to develop. From an economic development and limitation standpoint, I think I'm somewhat proud of the fact that for the last year, we've been able to kind of proactively prepare for economic development. This next year, we're going to react. There's not a whole lot more preparation. We're going to be reacting to a lot of the development proposals that are on the cusp of moving forward. One of the things that's in our economic development plan is a clear objective that we are not going to be able to address this coming year is the development and implementation of a business outreach program, something where we go out and reach out to our existing businesses, understand how they're doing, what we can do to help them out. We're not going to have the time or resources to do that this coming fiscal year. Point Oak Drive is another long-standing legacy issue that's out there that I think we're going to probably end up dealing in some form or another. We've established and funded, put some money in the budget to fund some final engineering design preparation that might help that existing private road to become a public road. But there's a lot of emotions, a lot of different opinions out on that street of how that might happen. It's not going to be an easy path forward. It's complex. And if we decide ultimately to move forward and spend time on that, it's going to have to be at the the expense of other things that are currently included in the proposed fiscal year 18 work program, because this is not something that we're expecting to spend a lot of time on this next fiscal year, but it is something that if we get involved with will require a lot of staff and council time. And then finally, last but not least, our zoning ordinance is more than 30 years old. Our sign ordinance is not up to speed with current case law. From staff's perspective, we need to ultimately move forward and perform a comprehensive revision of both of those ordinances. We're not going to be able to do that on either one of those documents this coming fiscal year, but it is something that we will revisit and look to talk with you again next year at this time about whether or not we can incorporate one or both of those into next year's work program. So with that, I leave you with our economic development goal that I talked about at the beginning of this conversation. Hopefully you'll see that our work program is advancing this goal, and open it up for any questions.
Thank you, Ron. Very impressive palette of potential paintings coming up in the next year of good things in the town. A lot of investment in our community. To council first, Alderman Davalos.
Thank you, Mayor. Wow, this is impressive. Even in the last year, when you gave your presentation a year ago, we were just starting to think about this. We were just at the ground level. The idea that in 1 year, this is all being set forward and that the foundation pieces are beginning to be in place is remarkable. So thank you for leading that effort, and to everybody who's in that department. I always carry around your of where we start and where we're going and who the people are, because they do an amazing job. I could pick a bunch of things to talk about, but the one thing I'm just going to talk about one, and that's the rental registration crime fee housing. We've talked about that for a while. There aren't decision packages for 2018, I see, so it's probably just discussion and stuff that's already in the budget. But I'm assuming whenever I see an article in the paper about this and what other communities are doing, I always cut it out. I have a big file of the communities in DuPage County and what they're doing, because it's not easy, and just how people are approaching it. So I'm assuming the decision packages will come in 2019, 2020, but that we will be getting there at some point to really devote some funds to that.
Yeah,
is that the plan?
Yeah, the plan from our perspective, and it's included in the work program, is to work through that discussion and decision process to decide whether or not it's actually something that we want to pursue as a community after we have an informed discussion of the pros and cons and costs and benefits of it. And then if that's the case, if we decide that we want to go down that path to some degree, then we can incorporate into next year's budget proposal the resources necessary to actually implement that type of program.
Okay, thank you.
And if I just would say, you talked about thanking staff and community development, and it truly is, you know, it's collectively the community development department. Everybody in the community development department is dedicated to this city. They work hard every day to advance all of these efforts. We worked with the rest of the city staff. We couldn't do it alone in the community development department. The rest of the city staff helps us accomplish these things on behalf of the community. But last but not least, the city council's consistent support and direction, expectations that you set for us to continue to achieve and push forward on these things has helped us continue to move forward. So thank you.
Alderman Goodman.
Ron, I really appreciate the way you tie so much of these presentations back to the strategic plan and to the economic development plan and the priorities that we as a council have set forth to guide our big picture discussions about what our staff is spending its time on, the priorities that we have as a community, and the way that we express those priorities by devoting staff time and resources and money towards those things. And, you know, I really appreciate the long-term planning that has been put into effect, you know, behind all of these items that you're presenting, the results of and the decision packages for. The fact that we don't just, you know, pull a rabbit out of a hat and say all of a sudden we're moving in a different direction. You know, we have years worth of work leading up to a particular desired goal. And, you know, some of the obvious examples from your presentation, the Southwest District, and how that's going to be moving forward so quickly this year, so much more quickly perhaps than we would have expected, given how many years some of these plans have been on the shelf and, you know, been waiting for the right time to really come to fruition. So thank you for your work and for your preparation that has enabled, you know, some of the good things that are going to be coming to Warrenville to happen. I noticed, for instance, on the work plan, one of the proposed new fiscal year 2018 projects and initiative that I particularly was excited about was coordinate construction of final phase of Route 56 streetscape enhancement project with Public Works. And that final phase part gets me so excited because I've been on this work group since 2007, I believe, and the idea that we're finally going to see the completion of that very long project is wonderful. I do have a couple of questions for you about the budget and a couple of decision items. One of the things that you mentioned in your presentation was that we had a record number of permit and inspections in this past year. So I was looking at the site plan review fees in the budget and the engineering review and inspection fees, and man, that is a volatile number. It seems to jump all over, and the budgeted amounts and then the projected amounts for 2017 don't really match up at all.
No.
And then the budgeted amounts for next year go in opposite directions. You know, you'd think both would increase or both would decrease, but actually the site plan review fees are expected to drop by 2/3, and the engineering review and inspection fees are expected to go up by about a factor of 4. But then if you look at what was budgeted for the engineering review for this year, it's about the same. Mm-hmm. So could you explain any of the sort of micro details of mm-hmm. why at least we're projecting this for this year?
To be frank, one of my least favorite jobs is to make those projections. We make those projections in December of this past year for the next fiscal year, and it really involves getting the crystal ball out and trying to project forward what type of projects are going to actually be working themselves themselves through our development entitlement process, will get approved, and then trying to project what type of building permits that we're going to be issuing, you know, in as a follow-up to that. And I can tell you, last year when we made these projections, we were anticipating that we were going to see a lot more of the projects that are kind of on the cusp of moving forward. Now, moving forward this current, the projects that we anticipate moving forward this next fiscal year, that we thought they would be moving forward this fiscal year based on some of the commitments that the developers were making to these projects. Civic Center redevelopment site number one, for example, you know, that was something that we fully expected, that the developer would be paying his final engineering review and inspection fees and pulling permits for this year. Obviously that didn't happen. That's been delayed in at least a year now. Bosch was committed to purchasing a large site and facility out in Cantera, remodeling the existing office building and building a separate research and development facility. And after it was all approved, including building permits, they decided that they weren't going to move forward. So those projections are challenging for staff to make because we have to look so far forward in advance. We do have a very detailed spreadsheet that when we make those projections that we populate based on the best available knowledge that we have when we make those projections. But certainly, as you've identified in the budget document, they can vary greatly depending on what actually happens.
Okay, I mean that makes perfect sense. And of course, the projection of what a developer is going to finish in a given year, even if you know they're working on it, the normal delays and even construction problems that can come up can mean that something projected for this year will be pushed into the next fiscal year very easily, especially, you know, weather during the construction season or who knows what. So that makes sense. On the decision packages, I was wondering if you could talk a little bit more. This is for those of you who have a budget. This is page 323, the Tortorielo Wetland Mitigation Bank.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, I'm just not sure we've done something quite like this before, at least not during my time on the council, so I'm not really sure what's involved in doing a project like that.
I mentioned during my presentation that we are in the process currently evaluating the constraints and details and potential opportunities that might be afforded by the wetland or by the Tortolello property. There are wetland, one of the things that we might decide to use that property for is creating kind of an area-wide wetland mitigation bank. Right now, a lot of the big development opportunity sites that are vacant in that area have small isolated pockets of wetlands on the property. In certain cases, developers under the Stormwater Management Ordinance have a right just to go fill those in and pay into a bank. In other cases, they can make a case that it makes sense to fill those smaller isolated wetlands in and pay into a bank. Right now, the city doesn't have a bank, a wetland bank. So the money is collected by the city and remitted to DuPage County, and then the county uses those monies to create wetlands in a master bank somewhere else in the county. Usually they try to use it in the local watershed, which would be the west branch of the DuPage River, but if there's no wetlands banks available in that, they can use it in other areas. The thought process is that, and we're trying to figure out, and we'll be discussing in the coming months with the City Council whether this makes sense for Warrenville, is there an opportunity to create a local wetland mitigation bank that the monies could stay in Warrenville, where we might enhance that kind of environmentally sensitive area that's in the city of Warrenville and improve that so it becomes more of an amenity and benefit for the overall Southwest District in incorporating maybe some type of extension of the trail improvements that we're proposing to see developers implement in that area and connect down to the Prairie Path through that kind of environmentally sensitive area. So that's a big picture concept. We're really early on in that process. The decision package would be something that we would tap into if the City Council decides that that's something that ultimately makes sense for us to move forward with financially from a future maintenance obligation standpoint and from a practical standpoint.
So we're not necessarily talking about, you know, building a park there now. This is all very long-term planning, and you know, obviously the McKee Marsh is a beautiful wetland amenity that we have near us, and the fact that this marshy, swampy area could be, you know, addressed in such a way or brought into a more healthy state that it could be used and enjoyed by people in a similar way, maybe long term.
That's at least the concept.
Yeah. Okay. And then my last question has to do with the Southwest District Redevelopment Site Number 1 Request for Proposals and Marketing Assistance. That's page 327 in the budget for anybody who's looking at it. I think that, you know, having some marketing assistance could certainly be useful, and I think that the way that we've approached getting developers for city property in the past might need some help. But I'm a little confused because I think the explanation on this page goes off the side of the document, and there might be some text missing.
Okay, I'm sorry about that.
So it pretty much says, I think it's the part where they're talking about what the money would be used for. Mm-hmm. It says the estimated expense is intended to cover the anticipa.
Okay.
And so I'm just trying to figure out like what the specific $60,000 is going to be used for.
So we've assembled that 8 acres of property that's located at the northeast corner of the intersection. It's vacant. It's a pretty attractive development opportunity site for the community. But unlike most property owners, the city's, in my mind, the city's motivations and the goals for selling property are more complicated than a typical seller. A typical seller wants to sell the property for as much as they can, as quickly as they can, with as little strings attached as possible. That's not the city of Warrenville. We assembled this property, and I think one of the reasons why we got involved with this property is to make sure that it was assembled and ultimately not just sold to a developer for any type of development, but was developed in a manner that would be determined and reflective of the best long-term interests of the city. So it's a little more complicated process to market the property because we have to communicate what the city's expectations are, and those aren't just the highest price. Those are what the outcomes of the development would be. So I think having a professional real estate development marketing brokerage firm help us refine what that those expectations are, making sure that they're reasonable from a market perspective, and then communicate those effectively out to the potential development communities in our best interest. And then ultimately, we're going to receive some type of development slash purchase proposals, and that same consultant can help us evaluate the economics of those proposals to decide which one best satisfies the expectations that the city has collectively established for that property.
So the $60,000 goes to the broker instead of some percentage of the, I mean, aren't most brokers paid just percentage of the sale price? Because I understand what you're saying, and I completely agree. Our motives in selling this property are not strictly related to the sales price, but the problem with hiring a broker in some cases is that their fee is strictly related to the sales price, and so their incentives don't match up with ours as well as we would like. So I don't know, is there any way to address that, or is there any way to change their compensation so that we're sure that we're happy?
Well, part of the process that the city would go through if we decided, when and if we decide to go forward and implement this particular decision package, is to have some kind of process to communicate to the type of consultant brokerage firms that I'm talking about what our expectations and goals are, so we could develop a professional services agreement or contract with that consulting firm that addresses the issue that you just talked about. So we have to first communicate with and get probably proposals from multiple consulting, development, marketing firms to help us and evaluate which one of those proposals best fits our needs, engage that firm, and then work forward to develop the marketing package and market the property. So the first step is finding and selecting a consultant that will actually work with us on this, and that's going to take some effort in and of itself.
Okay, that makes sense. Thank you.
Thank you, Alderman. Alderman Widener.
Yeah, thanks for the excellent report, and your staff is doing a great job, as well as you are, putting this great document together, all the documentation and the continuation of work that you guys do in the community development department. On page 5 of your report, you talk about the fiscal year 2018 accomplishments, the community quality of life enhancements. And I just wonder, if you could briefly explain some of the potential benefits and positive impacts that residents will realize upon completion.
In the presentation
of those
tonight?
Things? Yeah, on page 5, the Route 56 enhancements, the Illinois Prairie Path trailhead, the Mac Road Trail.
This one.
Here we go.
Yeah.
6.
Yes.
Keep going. Which way?
Page 5.
The slides are also numbered. Which slide are the slides?
Oh, okay.
Slide 9. Sorry.
Yes, that one.
Okay.
Just, I think those are important projects, and I think they tie in nicely to some of the economic development goals, and they'll just be nice features on the landscape. If you could just highlight, a couple of the benefits for each one, that'd be
sure.
Great.
So the Route 56 project has been going on. Route 56 enhancement project is something the city's been working on for a long period of time. It dates back to when we developed and adopted the Old Town Civic Center subarea plan. It established what type of improvements we wanted to see happen in the Route 56 corridor. We then used that plan to seek an outside grant that would help fund the implementation of some of those improvements. And we're at the final phase. We were able to get some of those improvements incorporated into the project that IDOT constructed out there. The center medium, the area of refuges that are available at the Batavia Road intersections, some of the other aesthetic and landscape enhancements that were incorporated into IDOT's project. We're part of that process, but there's a whole set of additional enhancements that we've been planning for, and we've been working through the IDOT review and design process. It's about $1 million worth of additional enhancements. Some of the most notable enhancements is the installation of a standard streetlight system at the Batavia Road Route 56 intersection, some enhancements to the Route 56 DuPage River Bridge, the construction of a new city monument sign at the west and east edges of the Route 56 expansion project, which would be a masonry sign somewhat similar to the example that's in the slide there, and there would be a new large masonry city identification sign at the southwest quadrant of the Batavia Route 56 intersection that would include a changeable message board that would be used by organizations in the community to announce community events and things of that nature. So it's a pretty significant series of enhancements that, again, the bulk of those would be like 75% of those are going to be paid for by the state and federal government. The city's share is the remaining portion. In terms of the Illinois Prairie Path Trailhead Project, last fiscal year, the city worked through a process with a group of stakeholders to identify what type of improvements could be made that would make the area out in front of City Hall more attractive to trailhead users, where trail users would take advantage of the improvements that the city has in this area and be the place where they might start and end their trips on the Prairie Path. The thought process is that you want to make it more comfortable for people, bathroom improvements, parking improvements, some seating improvements, things of that nature would be part of that trailhead improvement. Well, ultimately, the City Council endorsed a plan that had a couple different options of the type of improvements that we might want to ultimately install in that area to help establish this trailhead as something that would be attractive to people outside of our community. And what we're proposing here is, now that we have some outside funding commitment for the construction, is to move forward with the preliminary engineering design drawings for defining what that trailhead project really will look like, taking the conceptual design concepts and converting those into preliminary construction drawings. The Mack Road trail improvements right now, it's not a real comfortable area of the community for people in Fox Hollow trying to travel from, or anywhere on the west side of Route 59 to try to travel down the Mack Road corridor to access some of the high quality public open space improvements, Blackwell, McKee Marsh. And we've been talking about how we can improve the pedestrian bike crossings at the Route 59 intersection and then make sure that those people can safely and comfortably continue the travels and access the public open space improvements. We applied for a STP grant a year ago. We're awarded that grant and have been working on that preliminary design analysis that could ultimately result in the construction of a separate trail that would run parallel with the Mack Road corridor and incorporate some new pedestrian crossing improvements at the Route 59 Mack Road intersection. I don't know, is that addressed what your question?
Yeah, I think your emphasis on the fact that these are will be accomplished with a lot of grant funding and that it's not coming out of the city taxes. We didn't have to raise taxes for this, that it was your staff keeping alert for grant-funded opportunities and gaining a foothold for those opportunities. And now we'll see some really nice additions onto the landscape of the city. Thank you.
Alderman Hoffman.
How you doing? A couple different questions as far as, you know, last Monday we listened to Alderman Widener and Mayor Brimmel bloviate about inaccurate information and people being misled. The last time I seen the, I just in the paperwork you just given me here just 10 minutes ago, it was about the roundabout project. The last time I seen that was in March 14, 2016, as far as keyword here is projects not included in fiscal year 2017 work program. Roundabout grant application submittal or project advancement. Now you have it up here again here as far as on page 2. Projects, keyword again, projects not included in fiscal year 2018 work program. The fifth one down, roundabout grant application or final engineering design. Where does that project stand?
Dead for all practical purposes. The City Council gave clear direction, I don't know, 2 years ago, that nothing was going to happen on that project unless we secured any outside funding, and they directed us not to seek any outside funding. So the purpose for including that on the work program, identifying that as a project that's not being advanced, is because there's continued speculation in the community. Some are promoting that the city's secretly working on that. So we intentionally have continued to include it in that list of projects that we're not working on, so people know that we're publicly stating that we're not working on that project.
Okay, now is that anything as far as any other projects here? There's, let's see, 14 different projects that we have on there, but we're not going to, as far as Two Brothers redevelopment or any of that there, we're not going to pursue those. Or in the, this last one, there was five of them, I believe, like Manning Avenue sidewalk.
It's not in our work program. We're not planning to spend any additional time on that unless the City Council gives us direction to do so.
Okay, or until funding's available, correct?
Well, for which one are you talking about? The roundabout or?
For any of these. They're all on the same list, so.
Well, they're not all the same type of projects. I mean, the roundabout, for example, is a public infrastructure project that the council has made it clear that it's going to rely on, if it ever goes forward, it's going to have to be funded in large part by somebody else.
Correct.
Some of those other projects are projects that would be funded by the city of Warrenville if we decide to go forward. For example, you mentioned the Two Brothers. It's not, we're not talking about not working on the Two Brothers project. We're talking about not working on the public infrastructure improvements that would be necessary to Barclay Avenue to support that project. And yes, we're not working on that, and there's no funding established in this year's budget for that.
Okay, because it's obvious here, as I say, projects not included, so thank you.
Alderman Berry.
I'm very excited that you are very excited. I just love that you have this tone in your voice that you're ready to get to work on this, and I think that's what we're looking for, because when I first ran for alderman in 2005, that was the one thing that I spoke about at that time, was the improvements along Route 59. We started, and then we had to stop because the economy stopped. So I know that we, over the years, have worked towards this goal. And now that the economy has started to come around again, we're able to do these things. And this is what I'm so happy for. So I'd like to see our community move forward. And this is just an excellent example of what we can do with long-range planning and not standing still and not stopping, because maybe we don't have the money to do it right now, but we still have made plans. We're making plans all the time. And I like to congratulate you and everyone that works in community development and public works, and just everybody that's done a wonderful job with all of these things. So thank you very much.
Ron, I have a couple of things. I wanted to amplify a little bit on what Alderman Goodman had mentioned earlier in terms of sometimes the gap between a concept and actually seeing that concept come alive. And I just wanted to emphasize, my experience has been over the years that so much goes on behind the scenes to get from that concept to actually some sort of a project that's going to be built and is permitted. And I just want to emphasize that there are hours and hours and hours of work behind the scenes. When you talk economic development, it's not like going to the store and buying something off the shelf and then installing it when you get home. There's a lot of groundwork that has to be laid to make that possible. In our particular situation in Warrenville, as opposed to some other surrounding communities that have a lot of greenfield open space, if you have greenfield open space, that greenfield is basically a parcel of land that's available for development that doesn't have any issues for the most part. Developers gravitate towards those because it's a lot easier. There are fewer problems. They're going to make a profit a lot quicker. They're going to get their project done quicker. We don't have any greenfield open space in Warrenville. All of we have is what's called brownfield, which means it's going to be redeveloped, and it has issues. It has assemblage issues. It might have infrastructure issues. It has problems that those problems have kept those parcels from developing over a period of time, a lot of times for decades, because developers aren't looking at it, because they look at it and they say, oh, you don't have sewer and water, we're not interested. And they move on to where they can put it in very easily. So again, I want to emphasize that given our situation as a community, given that most of our opportunities here are redevelopment opportunities, a lot of preparation goes into getting to the point where you can say two brothers bought some property and they're going to build a really nice place for us. That didn't just happen because they saw it and it looked nice and they bought it. It happened because Ron spent hours and hours making sure the foundation for that purchase was laid. And that's true for almost every development that we're talking about here. All of those things take a lot of work. That person right there in his department makes that happen. The council makes decisions that facilitate what Ron's doing. But it all takes a lot of time and effort. So I really appreciate the fact that we have your dedication to do that. And we're finally going to see some things that have taken years in the making to accomplish, hopefully this coming year. It's going to be a very, very exciting year. The other thing that I wanted to emphasize, too, is because we don't have those greenfield opportunities, and most of ours, or almost all of them, are brownfield, the TIF is an excellent tool to help that sort of thing happen. Because some of these properties will never develop without the assistance of the community. Maybe you could take just a couple of minutes and inform people as exactly why a TIF is a good tool, especially in Warrenville, because of our situation.
Let me fire up the presentation I gave on that a couple weeks back, a month ago. No, the fact of the matter is that when you look at the Southwest District of our community, it's been pretty stagnant for the last 30 years. Not much has changed out there. I think there was a hot dog stand that got redeveloped into the now Gas City gas station, and there was a gas station that got redeveloped into a bank that they're talking about now converting back into a gas station. But that's about the extent of private investment and development that's happened out in anything significant out in that Southwest District. The community's been pretty stagnant. And a big reason for that is because there is a serious lack of public infrastructure in that area. Meaning that there's very little city sewer and water improvements. There's some pretty extensive and costly, complicated roadway improvements that need to be made to support what the community's expectations for quality development. We've had proposals for people trying to do a piecemeal development here or there or out there, but it's not something that would ultimately be reflective of what the community wants to see happen long term, which is coordinated, interconnected, high quality development. So the way to make that, what we've determined is one of the ways to help make that high quality development happen is to first clarify from the city's perspective, what are the expectations for development? So that's the sub-area plan. We've adopted a new sub-area plan that clearly articulates what we want to see happen out in that area. We've made sure that when we've developed that plan is something that the real estate market is going to implement. We didn't create a plan that the real estate market said, there's no way, no matter what you do, that doesn't make sense from a market perspective. So we have a market realistic plan, and then we move forward and develop the TIF district. The TIF district can provide a funding source. It's a tool that can help the city work with the developer to fund a lot of this public infrastructure that's not there that's necessary to support the development. So in Warrenville's experience, Cantera is a great example of that. You had a gravel pit, big hole in the ground, and the city entered into created a TIF district, entered into a TIF agreement with the master developer. That master developer invested millions and millions of dollars to kind of build the foundation for what actually came out of the ground out there. And under the TIF agreement, the city agreed to share back part of the new incremental increase in property taxes that all that development that happened out there created with the developer to offset some of the unique and extraordinary costs that the developer had experienced to get that property to develop. And, you know, it's a little different out in 59 because we're talking about kind of, and it's actually probably a little more complicated because we're talking about a bunch of different pieces and property owners and individuals and personalities that have to be assembled and coordinated to get that. But we're still talking about an area that is missing a large amount of really important public infrastructure. And really the best, one of the best ways the city can help make that happen without laying those infrastructure costs on a developer solely, which they're not going to absorb, it hasn't happened for the last 30 years, or tying it back to the rest of the taxpayers of the community, is to create a TIF district and work TIF agreements with those developers where they front the cost, put those extraordinary off-site utility and infrastructure improvements, and the city agrees to reimburse them for part of those costs with the incremental increased tax revenue that their projects generate.
And going back just a minute to Cantera, the 600-acre gravel pit, without the TIF in place and without the city setting up the design control regulations that had very high standards, what do you think the chances were that we'd have a Chewy's now or we'd have any of the things that we have out there?
You would have had piecemeal development. You would have had developers picking off the easy stuff around the perimeter of the property, the stuff that was the least expensive to develop. It would have been done in kind of a less coordinated, not as high quality, certainly not as high quality or coordinated manner as what ultimately happened.
Okay, thank you. And one last point. Sometimes when we announce that we've just purchased a piece of property or we're intending to purchase a piece of property, people say, why is the city buying property? We certainly have some very good reasons to do that. Perhaps you could enlighten folks and let them know why we might buy a particular piece of property and why that gives the city an advantage.
Well, I mean, there's a variety of reasons why we would buy that property. I think to answer your question, I think the most important reasons for the city to buy property is when the private sector hasn't kind of done what it needs to do to position that property to be a high-quality contributor to the city's long-term interests and goals. And an example, in my opinion, would be Civic Center redevelopment site number one, the Musselman property. That property, the city developed a clear sub-area plan for this area of the community, and it was clearly identified by the people in the community that participated in that planning process that the old kind of Class C industrial facility that occupied that property that was built before the city was a city, that the city kind of inherited, industrially zoned property, was just not consistent with the long-term vision and goals and what the community felt was appropriate for that particular piece of property at that location going forward. Unfortunately, the building had value from a real estate standpoint. You know, it was being leased out and it generated income as an industrial property. It's not what the city wanted, but it was, you know, made economic sense for whoever owned it at the time. It was for sale. There were individuals that were looking at buying it and kind of continuing that industrial use of the property. We were encouraging at the time. We talked to people that were interested in their property. Why don't you buy it and redevelop it? The city's long-term plans are redeveloping the property with some kind of moderate density residential use on the property. And all the developers that looked at it from that perspective said, it makes no economic sense for us to pay to purchase that property for what the market value is as is, and then invest additional money into dealing with the environmental remediation that need to be done and all the demolition improvements to prepare it for the type of development that the community felt was more appropriate. So in reality, economically, there was no path forward for that property to convert from the old industrial facility that was on the property to what the city's vision, the community's vision, which was this residential redevelopment, without the city's involvement. So the city ultimately decided it made sense to get involved. We have a TIF district, which when that property redevelops, it's going to generate new TIF incremental tax revenues that the city can use to repay itself for some of the extraordinary costs that it incurred to buy the property, tear down the old industrial facility, and do the environmental remediation and prepare it for residential development. So that's to me a perfect example of why the community, why a municipality or governmental agency would want to get involved with buying property for kind of an economic development purpose for something that really the community wants to see happen that otherwise wouldn't happen naturally.
And I think another example would be the Citgo property that The private sector probably will never change that from a low-quality gas station to anything better than that because of the investment they would have to make in order to do that. Their payback would be so long that they would never make that investment. So it's an opportunity for us to get involved if we're able to purchase it for a reasonable price, get the contamination cleaned up, then it's ready to be marketed for a purpose that the community would like to see it used for, which is new business that going forward will enhance the community as opposed to just sitting there and degrading every time it's sold. So similar situation?
It's very, very similar, and I would suggest, I'm a proponent of that perspective. I think the facility was built like 30-some years ago, and there's been virtually no private investment in that facility over the last 30 years for a variety of reasons. I think there's economic issues that play into that. A gas station at that location today is different than a gas station at that location 30 years ago. We now have the Winfield Road, Warrenville Road intersection, and the gas stations and other commercial improvements up there that weren't there when that thing got built. And in addition, there's floodplain issues that affect the future use and improvement of that property. The existing convenience store is located down in the floodplain and does flood in the heavy flood events. And because it's located in the floodplain, the state and federal regulations really limit what type of improvements and investments people can make to that facility. So it kind of is a downward, by itself, those regulations kind of, unfortunately, create kind of a downward spiral for the property. So that combines with the economics to make it somewhat unrealistic in my mind that the property is going to be redeveloped in the near-term future. It might be reused in kind of its existing form for some type of maybe not the most desirable commercial use.
Thank you, Ron. I guess my point about all of those questions and observations was that economic development is a simple term to think about, but it's a very, very difficult and complex term to actually bring to fruition, to make something happen. It takes a lot of time, a lot of planning, and of course, goals, which we have established as a council going forward for the future of the community. Sometimes you have to take a long-term view of something, and it takes a long time to get from point A to point B, but the goal is always to have something better than what's there. And Ron, you do a superb job of leading us and guiding us to make sure that we make good decisions going forward in that direction, so thank you. Great presentation, as always. Okay, last comment, Alderman Hoffman.
As far as the Citgo property, just set me straight on this because I keep hearing rumors about a previous owner that wanted to invest about $500,000 and they're improving it, but he decided to not do that for the simple reason is the city wouldn't allow a flood berm to be, the county to build a flood berm around Votel's property and that particular property. Where does that stand?
I've never heard that particular investment proposal. We have talked with the current owners of the property. They bought the property or they acquired this property through a bankruptcy proceeding from the company that used to own it for the last 5 or 7 years, early last calendar year, so just over a year ago. And one of the first things they came in and talked about is the possibility of subdividing the property and creating a gas station that would be focused around the existing improvements and utilizing the kiosk facility is kind of what would run the gas stuff out and carving off the building that would be in the floodplain portion of the property and using it kind of as is for a liquor store. And from the city's perspective, there's a lot of reasons why that didn't make sense. And part of that was you couldn't do significant investments to the existing convenience store building because it is located within the floodplain. And furthermore, when they tried to subdivide the property, they were going to, create all kinds of non-conforming issues with setbacks. They weren't proposing to really do anything with the existing impervious areas out on the property. You'd basically have what's out there just now two separate businesses operating on it, and I don't think they were going to make any significant improvements. I never heard the number of $500,000 worth of improvements. Maybe that was partially to relocate the underground storage tanks from out in front of the convenience store to the actual gas station component of the property.
Thank you.
Okay, thank you, Ron. we'll move on to the balance of the meeting. Citizens' comments. We have several people who have signed up this evening. I would ask that you come to the podium, state your name and your address, and try to stay within a three-minute limit. People that want to speak, and I will call you in order. First, Chris Lavelli. Chris, would you like to come up, please?
Hello. My name is Chris Lavelli. I live 3 South.
We want to make sure you're heard on TV.
I live off of Lakeview Fork and Bayshack. My concern is the water between Lakeview and Harvest. There's standing water between the cul-de-sacs.
Hold on, Chris. We're
right.
Sorry.
My wife's so loud, so I can't help that out. How's that? Better? Nothing? Hello? Is that better? Okay.
There we go.
Thank you.
You're on.
Okay, so I live off of Lakeview Court, and the concern is between Lakeview and, I believe, Harvest. There's standing water between these cul-de-sacs for at least 6 months out of the year. The other 6 months is either mud or it's frozen. The water never dissipates. We have exposed cable, exposed ComEd wires, exposed all these things that are there permanently. It's kind of a nightmare. The fences rot in that area continuously just because it's always in standing water. The water never dissipates, ever. Actually, four of my neighbors actually came with me just because it's such a problem for us. And, you know, to listen to what you guys are doing here, it's great and all, but I wish you could spend a little bit and make the life of the people of Summer Lakes a little bit easier, because it's not fun when your backyard is mud all the time. It just isn't fun, and hopefully you guys can help us.
Thank you, Chris. Vivian Lund.
Well, I'm dumbfounded. I'm so glad I was here for this presentation. I mean, there's some of it that we were working on when I was mayor. I mean, at the beginning of when I was mayor. So there was something that came up, the Tortellini property, the one, it was like 11 cousins, and I communicated with all 11 cousins trying to get them to put the land together so that maybe they could do something with it. And that was back in the 80s. So now they gave it to us, so that's nice. The reason I'm here is I'm Vivian Lund. I live on Haylett. I was mayor from 85 to 2005, and I had to be mayor for 20 years because I had to lay my body down over a quarry so that we could have Kenterra. And we're still dealing with some of the same thought processes that about encouraging our local officials to do what you are doing so well. And the long-term planning and the staff that you've assembled we are so blessed. And I want you to know that when I go anywhere in this county and talk to people in other cities, and I tell them I'm from Warrenville, and they say, oh, you really have a good community there. You've done a good, I mean, not me. You have continued to do just a really good job. But what I wanted to talk about, I knew that John had this chart in the budget document. I remembered seeing it when I read it. And I keep hearing people, in fact, two people called me this week to ask me why our property taxes are so high. And that would take a lot longer than 3 minutes. But I think it's more important for you to understand what part of city services we actually, as individual homeowners, pay for the services that we get. And you can look at your own tax bill. find the part that says city. And that amount of money is a very small amount of your property tax, your total property tax. Our rate is high because our values are low. And we're working on that, but it takes a long time. But this blue spot represents how much comes from the property taxes we pay on our homes or our businesses or whatever. The rest of this is the general fund that are the services that we receive from the city, except for sewer and water. That's not part of this. This is how much they spend on all these things that we love in our community. We enjoy good roads, good police service, good development planning. We get so much more than we pay for. So we pay for this much. All of this comes from other sources. So even though we're only paying 10% of our total tax bill, about 10%, to the city, we're really getting much more than that 10% is being used to provide us with the services and improvements and whatever we have that comes from the city government. And one of the reasons that our property values are lower than the larger cities is because Warrenville started with a lot of small homes. We had developers that came, and that was long before I was around, involved. But all of Summer Lakes, Fox Hollow, River Oaks, the one where everybody's so happy out
Maple
there,
Hill.
Maple Hill, the one in the center, the one across from the Presbyterian Church.
Warrenville Lakes.
All of those were Edgebrook, Thornwild. You know, we have like 17 subdivisions, and all of those were done with pretty modest housing. So Naperville has all these really big million houses or whatever they call them. Warrenville has probably maybe 100 of that size house. Well, when you have big houses and big development, when you you can have a smaller levy. But you're not going to believe me. You're not going to understand that. But I just want you to see that what you're paying for, you're getting a lot more than what you're actually paying for. And if you were going to reduce this, tell me what you want us not to do. You know, do you want a smaller police department? Do you, not a good one. Do you want less road work done? Do you want less snow plowing done? Do you want, I mean, you're getting direct services. We're not even paying interest on debt. We pay, all the money goes to real stuff. So I just, you know, it's really very frustrating to me when I know how hard and how frugal we have been and how hard we have worked to have good financial management. I just get very upset when I hear people say our taxes are so high, and then I hear somebody else say, well, we'll just elect somebody that'll reduce our taxes. Well, the only people that can reduce that are those people up there, and all they can reduce is this one-third. They could take a little out of that, but not much, and still they could take it all out. And so what would you have? I mean, this is $3 million, and it costs $20 million or something to run our city for a year. So you're getting a really good deal, and I hope we can keep trying to help you understand that. Thank you for letting, I think I went over 3 minutes.
Maybe just a smidge. Bob Siebert will give you some of his time. He's generous that way. Adam Glickman.
Thank you.
Hi, my name is Adam Glickman. I don't live in town. I do business in town. I called you, Mayor, and I didn't get a call back. That's I wanted to talk to you about this matter. Basically, I'm a small businessman, been in business for about 30 years. We do gumball machines, and we have the Family Food Center in town. And your finance director said there's a permit for the machine. So I said, okay, how much is the permit? He said, $50 a slot. We have 5 slots on one machine, 6 slots on the other machine. We cannot pay $250. Can't afford it. We deal with the kids, you know, and basically a pop machine is $50. They might have 8 selections, but 1 slot. And they got bill acceptors. We deal with quarters and 50 cents. We haven't raised our prices in 30 years. We can't raise our prices. And, you know, we bring a lot of good stuff. I hope you're all Cubs fans. We got Cubs stuff, you know. So we have nice stuff for the kids, animals that light up and everything. And everybody over here must have used a gumball machine as a kid. So that's what I need your help with.
So specifically you're asking...
Well, asking for help cannot pay the $250. I could pay something, but I don't understand. You know, we're bringing a smile to a kid. We're not bringing danger to the kid. So we're asking to revise or to look into the matter about you're going to put us out of business at $250. We're just not making it. The machines don't make like a poker machine. You know, a poker machine, I don't know if they're legal in this town, but okay. Well, it's not a poker machine in other towns only pay $25 to the towns. But I guess they, you know, share revenue and whatever. But what I'm saying, we're dealing with quarters and 50 cents.
I understand. What you're asking for is a reduction of the permit
fee.
Yes,
yes.
Okay, well, that would be something that would have to be brought forward for the council to decide. I would say make your case with staff and see if, I don't know, has staff considered this already? Kevin?
I have spoken with Mr. Glickman on the phone. We have not, it hasn't all been all that long ago. There really hasn't been a chance to even bring the issue forward at this point. We certainly could bring that to the finance committee, not probably this next time, but we could certainly bring that for consideration if that's something the council is interested in doing. We've applied the codes as it exists now, and that can only be changed by you as a council.
Okay, well then we'll take a look at it.
Okay, thank you.
Mm-hmm. Bob Siebert. Batting cleanup. We've used up a lot of time, Bob. Can you do it in 3?
Actually, I have Vivian's watch, and you'll have the same 3 minutes.
You're already in the hole, though, so it won't help you.
Bob Siebert, Albright Court. Can the city manage the TIF districts to ensure that at the end of the TIF, the property tax payers all in the city receive a reduction? The answer is yes. We can manage the TIF to ensure that at the end of the TIF, 23 years, every individual property tax holder, City of Warrenville, would receive a reduction in their property tax. Actually, this is what economic development is supposed to be. It's supposed to benefit the individuals that are in the community. Not developers, not other people, but the individuals in the community. If, on the other hand, you do nothing, TIF 3, TIF 4 will be identical to TIF 1 and TIF 2 with large hidden tax increases on the property tax for everybody in the community. There will be no reduction, period. 3 years ago, the City of Warrenville was requested by the chairman of DuPage County, Dan Cronin, to come to a private meeting with the state's attorney, the county clerk, elected officials, to discuss this issue. City of Warrenville decided they did not want to come to the meeting. The City of Warrenville chose not to gain this information. If the citizens of Warrenville are to gain from economic development, you have to understand how to manage a TIF district to benefit the property tax payers.
Thank you, Bob. Informative as always. We'll move on to official and staff comments, beginning with the mayor. A couple of things just to amplify on what Vivian mentioned about property tax. Do keep in mind that your property tax bill is a lot of taxing bodies. The City of Warrenville is only one of them. Currently, the amount of your property tax bill that goes to the City of Warrenville is 9% of the bill. So if your property tax bill is $5,000 a year, the City of Warrenville gets $450 out of that $5,000. The rest of it goes to other taxing bodies. So please keep that in mind when someone talks to you about the importance of lowering our tax rate, which if you compare to other communities is fairly reasonable and actually a bargain compared to a lot, that lowering your tax bill 5% or 10% of what you owe the city, in the case of the $450, 10% is $45 a year, and you multiply that by all the taxpayers, that would mean we'd have to reduce services significantly because we would lose that revenue. So the investment you make by paying your taxes to the City of Warrenville is actually a pretty good investment. I think Vivian made a good point. The other thing is the roundabout, which a dead project that refuses to die because certain people will not let it die for whatever reason. There is no plan to do the roundabout. The council never, ever at one point voted to build the roundabout. There was never a vote to do that. What the council did was they looked at an intersection that had been discussed for decades as kind of an awkward intersection and looked at ways to improve that intersection if the council determined that that improvement was going to be a good thing. They looked at, I think, six different alternatives of what to do to improve that intersection. They chose as their preferred alternative to build a roundabout. Okay, that did not say they voted to build the roundabout. They only chose that as if we move ahead with improving that intersection, we'd like to see a roundabout built there. Then they put a condition on that, and they said unless we get outside funding, specifically what was applied for was a CMAQ grant, a pollution mitigation grant, Unless we get that grant, we're not moving forward with the roundabout. I don't know how much clearer you can get. When the grant didn't come through, the roundabout is dead. The council decided that if without the grant, no roundabout. So there's nothing in the budget for a roundabout. No matter what you hear when somebody knocks on your door, there's no plan to build the roundabout. And the staff or the elected officials, none of them, are searching out additional funds from outside the city in order to facilitate the roundabout being built. The roundabout is dead, period. It's not coming up again unless at some future date, because we can't make promises for the people that come after us. Someone in the future may think it's a good idea and bring it up again. But for now, there's no active consideration, and there's no one that's sitting here that has any intention of building that roundabout. I don't know how much clearer I can be with that. Anybody who comes to the door and says different is either misinformed or more likely trying to misinform you and mislead you. It's dead. On a lighter note, I got to go out today with the DuPage Senior Citizens Council. I do this once a year. I guess it used to be called Meals on Wheels. They're calling it the March for Meals. A very, very nice little program where volunteers take a meal to shut in people in the community every day of the week. They take them a nice, nutritious meal. They chat with them for a while. They do a wellness check to make sure they're okay. Today, I got to go along throughout the city of Warrenville and chat with some folks that maybe that was the high point of the day, that someone actually came and spent a few minutes talking with them. So I just wanted to highlight that for all that you hear about going on in the world, all the hate and all the nonsense, there are still some very, very good people that on the level of the local community do some really, really nice work for needy people. So I wanted to thank the people that are involved in that program. And that's probably the fifth or sixth year that I've done that. And it's a really a privilege to see them because you have the same people always going to the same houses and they chat about the same stuff. And to see those people's eyes light up when you ring the doorbell is really very rewarding. So that's all I have. Kirk?
Did you want to say something about the candidates night tomorrow night?
I'll let you do that.
Leah, are you going to do it?
Go. Yeah, I figured somebody would.
I'll let Alderman Goodman do it. Thank you.
All right.
Just has to.
Then we'll go right to Alderman, and we'll start with Alderman Goodman.
Yeah, I was going to announce that the League of Women Voters, in conjunction with the Chamber of Commerce, is hosting a candidates' night tomorrow here in this room. I believe it starts at 6:30. There's going to be a group of candidates for the District 200 School Board. There's going to be the mayoral candidates, and there are going to be the aldermanic candidates for Ward 1. So I believe that's four people here in this room. And it's going to be a nice event, give everybody a chance to see the candidates in person. I plan to be there. The second thing I wanted to announce is that once again, our wonderful police department has scheduled a cop on a rooftop event. So mark your calendars now. It's a little ways out, but it's scheduled for Friday, May 19th, from 5 a.m. to 2 at the Warrenville Dunkin' Donuts on Route 59. They're going to be fundraising for the Illinois Special Olympics, which is a wonderful cause that our police department has historically supported very strongly. And so there'll be, you know, police officers there, probably flashing lights and sitting up on the roof of the Dunkin' Donuts like they do every year. So mark your calendars now, and you can make a donation to a really great cause and get a coupon for a free donut or maybe a shirt or something. So everybody, please support our police department in that effort.
Thank you, Alderman. And then going back to the candidates' night, it will be recorded tomorrow night, so it will be available on Channel 10 and our YouTube channel, correct? Okay, Channel 10 at least. All right, so you will be able to see it. If you're unable to participate and stop down here, you'll be able to watch it at a later time on Channel 10. Anyone else? Alderman Hoffman.
As far as these TIFs, the city property tax would be also high because of, but any other taxing district that is solely supported by Warrenville would also be raised because of it. As far as the roundabout, I, again, as I say, You know, the people in town here aren't naive. We're going after the city's pursuing the Sitco property. It's exactly where the roundabout was supposed to be built as far as the drawings go. Faye Johnson property and the L. Wengren property have been purchased. It's quite clear to me, and I think it is to most other people, just simply that it's mentioned on these, as I say, keyword projects not included in fiscal year 2018 work program, roundabout grant application. We know the state that the federal government and the state government is in financially. Why waste staff time applying for applications or final engineering design? It only takes one vote to get it passed through, bring it up on the council, and we've many times have seen where they've jumped past had put a item, as there is tonight, that never seen a committee meeting that goes right through the council. I don't think they're fooling anybody, Mayor. Thank you.
Thank you, Alderman. Anyone else? Alderman Wilson.
The roundabout is dead. Please bury it. Thank you.
Thank you, Alderman. Alderman Davalos.
Yes, we've talked TIFs and taxes and levies. I just want to say two things. I may need Finance Director Dahlstrom's help on this to make sure I don't misspeak. But the city has not asked the property owners in Warrenville for any more money in the last about 12 years. Now, the rate changes, it's a complicated formula, but we don't raise the amount of money that we ask you for, even though we could under the tax cap. Second thing is, at a meeting, I think it was this year, unless it was at the end of last year, we voted on the levy, and we're told that this coming year, a house worth $200,000 would have a tax decrease from Warrenville, not your whole tax bill, just Warrenville. I think it was $20, or was it $30 for $200,000 valuation? Was that what you had mentioned?
I don't remember the exact amount, but it was something like that. Correct.
So it would be double if your house was worth $400,000. You'd probably get back $60 this year. So it's working. I don't know how that would happen unless there was development to offset, to kind of share in that so that the residents would be paying a little bit less. So all these things we're doing, that's not an extraordinary amount of money, but as was mentioned in citizens' comments, the part of your tax bill that is Warrenville is relatively small. Not insignificant, but relatively small. So you may, whether you see your tax bill go down, if somebody else is going to raise taxes, that's another thing. But I just want you to know that this is one of the reasons I vote for reasonable development is I don't want my taxes to go up. I live here too. And I am very proud of the fact that we can say they're going down. So I just want everybody to know that when they're deciding how they feel about this whole issue. Thank you.
All right, City Administrator.
I have nothing to add tonight, thank you.
And City Attorney.
I have nothing tonight, thank you, Mayor.
All right, we'll move on to the agenda for this evening. Alderman Widener.
I move to approve the agenda for the March 20th, 2017 City Council regular meeting.
Second.
Second by Alderman Davalos. Any changes to the agenda? Alderman Hoffman.
I'd like to pull Jay off.
Jay? Motioner and seconder agree to that change to the agenda?
Yes.
And okay.
Mr. Mayor?
Yes.
Item 6C, because we're waiving competitive bidding, I would suggest that we remove that item.
Okay.
Even if no one's against it, that way we'll have a specific roll call vote on that item since we're waiving competitive bidding.
Okay, could I ask one of the aldermen to pull that item? Alderman please, Widener?
Please. Pull item C and amend the motion to include all the other items except for C and J that we're pulling from tonight's agenda.
Okay, and the seconder agrees. Alderman Davalos.
Yes.
Okay, all right. So we're all set with an amended agenda for this evening. All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carries. We have a couple sets of minutes that need to be approved also. Alderman Widener?
Move to approve the minutes of the March 6, 2017 City Council regular meeting and to approve the minutes of the March 13, 2017 Community Development and Planning Committee of the Whole regular meeting.
Second.
Motion and a second. Any discussion of those minutes? Changes? Seeing none, all in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carries. The minutes are approved. The consent agenda as amended for this evening reads, item 6A, accept staff recommendation, waive second reading, and pass ordinance number 02017-08, adopting a revised 2017 zoning map for the city of Warrenville. B, accept plan commission recommendation, waive second reading, and pass ordinance 02017-09, approving Gagner's plat of subdivision 3 South 080 Williams Road. D, accept community development committee recommendation, waive second reading, and pass ordinance number 02017-11, approving the recapture agreement for Route 59 Duke Parkway intersection, roadway, and city sanitary sewer and water main related improvements. E, accept community development committee recommendation, waive second reading, and pass ordinance 02017-12, approving a new intergovernmental agreement between the City of Warrenville and the City of Aurora regarding the Duke Parkway and Route 59 intersection improvements. F, accept Community Development Committee recommendation, waive second reading, and pass ordinance 02017-13, approving the plat of dedication for Duke Parkway right-of-way. G, accept Community Development Committee recommendation, waive second reading, and pass ordinance 02017-14, approving the Barclay Avenue right-of-way plat and authorize the plat to be executed and recorded at the DuPage County Recorder's Office once the city takes title to the Lang property. H, accept Community Development Committee recommendation and pass resolution R2017-09, authorizing senior civil engineer Hawking to execute a final engineering design services contract with Webster, McGrath, and Alberg Limited for the extension of the Landon Avenue sanitary sewer to Route 59 and direct staff to prepare an FY 2017 budget amendment to cover these costs. I accept staff recommendation and pass resolution R2017-10, approving an agreement between the City of Warrenville and Langdon Group to provide grounds landscape maintenance services for various city-owned properties in the amount of $23,179. K, accept Community Development Committee recommendation and authorize the Plan Commission to conduct a public hearing to consider amendments to the text of the zoning ordinance. L, accept Community Development Committee recommendation and approve the request of the Warren Tavern Preservationist to fund the Warren Tavern's metal roof replacement and authorize city staff to include a revised total not to exceed $21,000 in the FY 2018 budget. M, receive and file minutes of the Bicyclist and Pedestrian Advisory Commission regular meeting held on February 8th, 2017. And receive and file draft minutes of the Plan Commission and Zoning Board of Appeals regular meeting held on March 9th, 2017. O, receive and file report of invoices paid up to March 15th, 2017 in the amount of $41,274.65. P, authorize expenditures for invoices due on or before April 3rd, 2017 in the amount of $290,992.51. And Q, receive and file report of debit card expenditures for the month of February 2017 in the amount of $2,422.07. Alderman Widener?
Move to approve the agenda as presented by Mayor Brummel.
Second.
Motion and a second. Member roll call, please.
Alderman Berry?
Aye.
Alderman Widener?
Aye.
Alderman Hoffman?
Aye.
Alderman Wilson?
Aye.
Alderman Ashower?
Aye.
Alderman Goodman?
Aye.
Alderman Bevier?
Aye.
Alderman Demelos?
Aye.
Thank you, Emily. Well, we'll go back to the two items that were removed from the consent agenda, item 6C. Alderman Widener, did you wish to bring that forward?
Yes, I move to accept the Community Development Committee recommendation, waive second reading and pass ordinance 02-2017-10, approving a development agreement between the City of Warrenville and Duke Realty regarding Duke Parkway / Route 59 intersection related public infrastructure improvements and future public easement dedications, and waive the competitive bidding for the sewer and water improvements of Duke Realty will install for the City of Warrenville.
Second.
Second by Alderman Bevere. Any discussion of that item? Seeing none, may I have a roll call, please?
Alderman Hoffman?
Aye.
Alderman Wilson?
Aye.
Alderman Bevere?
Aye.
Alderman Berry?
Aye.
Alderman Goodman?
Aye.
Alderman Davalos?
Aye.
Alderman Widener?
Aye.
Alderman Ashower?
Aye.
Thank you. Motion carries. We will return to item 6J. Alderman Hoffman, did you wish to bring that forward?
Accept Community Development Committee recommendation and endorse the City of Warrenville Tax Increment Financing Redevelopment Project Assistance Policy dated March 15th, 2017. I'm going to be voting no on this.
Second.
Okay, motion and a second. Any additional discussion, Alderman Hoffman? Is that it?
No additional discussion. I believe we shouldn't be using these TIFs, so that's why I'm voting no on it. Thank you.
Okay, anyone else? Alderman Goodman?
I just wanted to thank staff for making the change that I asked for last week. And going through these very detailed priorities, the reasoning behind it, and the fact that they were able to explain, in such detail, the reasoning behind this plan. I really appreciated that, and I think that, having my questions answered makes me feel very comfortable moving forward with this policy.
Thank you, Alderman. Alderman Widener.
Yeah, I'd just like to comment on the positive nature of TIFs, that they've been used across the state of Illinois in a very successful manner, and they've enhanced a lot of communities with the development. They've increased property values, and they've provided a lot of beneficial results in the state, and certainly within our community. We've seen the most successful TIF ever created in Cantera, which provides many benefits to the residents and to the City of Warrenville. Thank you.
Thank you, Alderman. I would just add that you could take the state statute books for the state of Illinois and open them to a random page and point to a statute, and you would be hard-pressed to find one that doesn't have some negative impact somewhere to somebody or something. So to say that we're against TIFs because they may have some nebulous negative impacts that we might identify if we look at them through a certain lens, and you try to balance that against the enormous benefits that we're able to get for the community through TIFs, especially taking properties that would almost never, certainly in the private sector, develop without that community involvement, and turning those into positive things, taking a gravel pit, turning it into a world-class, award-winning mixed-use development. That would simply not have happened without using the TIF as a tool. The TIF is a tool. We use it very, very well. We should be in the textbook under how to use TIFs, Warrenville, right here. Follow their example. You want to see how not to use it? Go a little farther east and go into Chicago, where it's basically a piggy bank for the elected officials. We don't do that. We follow the rules. We use the TIFs in a way that benefit the community long-term, far, far outweighing the possible negative impact. If your property taxes went up 13 cents a year because we were able to have a TIF, I think most of you would say that's a heck of a bargain. And generally, if you even identify some of these impacts, they are pennies to the taxpayer. So again, we use TIFs because they're an effective tool. Yes, they might have some downsides. Again, if you look at them from a certain perspective, through a certain lens, you might be able to identify some impact that you say, well, this isn't so good. Compare that to the benefit of the community. There is no comparison. They're hugely, hugely beneficial tools when used properly. We use them properly here. If you don't believe me, go to Cantera, where they're building another new restaurant right now, because we had a TIF to turn that gravel pit into a nice development. Time for vote. Oh, do we have another comment? Ah, I'm sorry. Sorry. Alderman Hoffman.
Yeah, I would just like to point out that...
I thought you were done. I'm sorry. You said you were done.
Well, then we continued the conversation. I figured I would continue also.
Oh.
As far as these TIFs go, you know, it's not only my position that they're increasing property taxes, not only inside the TIF, but also outside the TIF. It's also our county clerk, Paul Hines. That's his position on it also. If you just kind of look at the situation we're at here, you know, Naperville has only used one TIF, and that started last year, and they actually probably did it properly. It's a very small TIF. It's on the water street. It's a hotel going up there. And they put it on a pretty much one block area, so there's no additional infrastructure that they have to maintain because of that. It's going to be inside that one little area. So in turn, you look down I-88 through Naperville. It's pretty much all built out. Here, Cantera is right on an interchange there. And we have vacant buildings, vacant land. You know, why there hasn't been a study done on that, on the situation that Warrenville's in to this point, I have no idea. But you know what? You look at Route 59. From Monarch Landing south, there's businesses up and down. It's completely, almost completely built out. You cross the city on property, the city line there, and we got vacant land. We have people donating land to Warrenville because they can't sell it and they're tired of paying the taxes on it. There has to be a problem there. These corporations have got to be crunching the numbers. They're seeing that our taxes are too high, and they're just not buying. They're not going to come in town and complain about it. They're just not going to come in town. It's quite apparent to me that there's a problem that needs to be dealt with, and it hasn't been to this point. Thank you.
Alderman Goodman.
I have to respond to what was just said, because the idea that somehow there's some inherent problem with Warrenville having put in TIFs that's keeping developers from coming to town is somewhat at odds with reality. When we just sat here and listened to a Community Development Department presentation in which we were informed that our Community Development Department has reviewed a record number of permits and inspections in the past year and is expecting a roughly as large number in the coming year. To blame some unspecified ills and some vacant property on the existence of a TIF in parts of Warrenville, when the idea of a TIF statute and the only reason that you can legally be justified in creating a TIF is when you have vacant and blighted and undeveloped or sometimes impossible to develop properties that are perhaps polluted or perhaps split up into such small lots that they can't be assembled into developable parcels. I mean, the number of reasons that you're citing as problems in the community are exactly the same reasons that are supposed to be addressed by TIF and is the purpose behind creating a TIF under state law in the first place. You've been told this before. You've had the details of TIF law explained to you. So I would appreciate you being more accurate in the way that you talk about it, having been told these facts before and not having learned them. I think generally speaking, the idea that people are afraid that our new TIF will turn out like TIF 1, as I think a citizen commented earlier, really surprises me, because I would be so thrilled if our current TIF 4 turned out like TIF 1. I don't think that we can possibly expect it to be as successful as TIF 1. I only wish that would turn out as well as the development in TIF 1 did. It's been such a success here in Warrenville. We have such a track record of taking a big hole in the ground and turning it into beautiful commercial and industrial and retail and residential buildings that have been providing benefit and tax dollars in our community and places to shop and hotels to stay at. It surprises me with such a very clear, positive example in front of us that we have to show how successful TIFs can be when they're done right, that there's still this suspicion or negative inferences that people seem to pull out of nowhere. And I really think that we would have learned better from our own personal experience. Thank you.
Alderman Hoffman.
I'd just like to point out that as far as in this new economic development, FY 2018 goals, economic development says anticipated projects. Well, out of the five projects, four of them are housing. Well, the problem with housing is that developers are coming in here, buying a property up relatively cheap because our property values are depressed because of the higher taxes. And what's happening is they build a house, they sell them, and they don't care because they don't have to pay the property taxes on them. Thank you.
Fortunately, I don't know what to do with that, so I guess we'll take a vote. May I have a roll call, please?
Alderman Ashower.
Aye.
Alderman Goodman.
Aye.
Alderman Widener.
Aye.
Alderman Bevere.
Aye.
Alderman Wilson.
Aye.
Alderman Berry.
Aye.
Alderman Davalos.
Aye.
Alderman Hoffman.
No.
Okay, on to the regular agenda. We have two items there. The first is a consideration of a FY 2018 budget decision package for Harvest Court drainage improvements. Do we want to just have a discussion and then let that lead to a motion? That seems like the likely way we should handle this, so let's do it that way. I would preface, Mike, the comments and the discussion by thanking the people who came this evening for their patience to wait for this to roll around so we could talk about it. It was a long meeting. We do this every Monday night, so you're welcome to come back anytime you like. At any rate, we're going to get to your discussion right now. So we're going to have our Assistant Public Works Director, Kukler, Director. Sorry, what did I say? Okay. lead the discussion.
Thank you. In the past, we've received numerous requests over the years for city assistance with private drainage projects. And in my experience here for 7 years and for some years before that, city staff's answer has typically been we don't have a program in place or dedicated funding to help address those projects. It doesn't mean they're bad projects. And there are very many, I term as maybe nuisance projects, but as these people described earlier, where their backyard is unusable for, or at least a portion is unusable basically the entire year. When Administrator Coakley and Christine and I went out to visit a resident the other day, they showed like a third of the yard that they fence off because it's just wet constantly. And they've got dogs that it turns into a big mud pit. Alderman Bevere met with these residents last year, brought forward an alderman request last fall, and this was after coordinating with staff, with Christine and Jamie Clark to visit the site, walk through, and determine what the problem was, identify what a solution would be. There's a city storm sewer in the backyard where you could extend that a couple hundred feet to help pick up some of these active sump pumps and help gather some of the surface drainage. And then Christine helped with a cost estimate, which was the basis for Alderman Bevere's alderman request. The concern that was raised during the budget process, when we started looking at this, was more of a big picture item. It's not that this is a bad project. It's a worthwhile project to help out residents who have a problem. And this project would help out about 6 to 8 properties that have varying degrees of drainage issues in their backyards. The bigger picture is that we don't have a program in place or dedicated source of funding to deal with the requests that had come in previously. So we've already said no to people as similar projects, maybe not the exact same project. And we know there are going to be more requests in the future. Our street supervisor, Jamie Clark, received a request somewhere else in Summer Lakes just in the last couple of weeks, again, with a similar rear yard drainage project that affects multiple properties. So what we need to know tonight is if City Council wants to start allocating resources, including staff time and funding for design and building some of these projects, then the next step from our perspective would be for staff to put together a recommendation for a program, which would include a variety of things, the amount of funding per year, what constitutes a drainage problem. There's a variety of things I outlined in my memo that are issues we need to consider as part of this program, and then bring that back to council in either August or October, the Public Works Committee meeting, to discuss. And then if council adopts a program at that time, we would have a space in the budget, this alternate decision package that is Exhibit B to my memo. It's for $50,000. It's for a private property drainage project that could be used to construct a project this year.
the Harvest Court and Lakeview Court drainage project is a project that would fit well in one of these. It's consideration as part of a program like this, but without, it's a bit awkward to tell these people yes, and we've told other people no over the years, and when we don't know how to respond to people in the future because there's just this funding of one single project. So I'd be happy to answer your questions at this time.
My question, I would have just a quick question so that I make sure I understand. What you're asking for is funding of a program for going forward for a lot of these legacy problems that we faced over the years and we haven't been able to deal with, because as a policy, generally we said we don't do drainage problems on private property. Now we're looking at changing that policy. We're funding a fund to begin that change. And this particular project that's brought forward tonight would then be eligible for that fund?
Yes, and what we're recommending tonight is a funding of a single project for this year. And so we have and that'd be contingent on council adopting a program to address these projects going forward. That'd be include criteria to evaluate projects. If we had five projects come in or requests come in 1 year to evaluate and rate those. If there's one project comes in that fits the criteria, and this again is the type of project I would envision that would fit the criteria for city assistance. But I think the first step is to know whether council really wants to entertain this or not. If the answer is no, if there's a majority of council that doesn't want to assist with these type of projects, and there's really no point in putting anything in the budget or moving forward on it. However, if the majority council would like to move forward and consider something like this, then the first step beyond it is to put the $50,000 decision package in the budget. So we have funding this year for a project. I don't know whether $50,000 a year is going to be enough. It's going to be too much for council. I mean, that's part of what developing this program would be, is to decide what level of funding, if any, council is interested in investing in these types of projects.
Okay, so assuming the council wishes to go forward with your proposal tonight, how soon would it be before you could actually implement a project that was presented that met the guidelines?
I would say construction would be next spring of 18.
Okay, so it's, all right, reasonable time frame. Alderman Bevere?
Yeah, we had a lot of them projects going on when I was street superintendent in Summer Lakes, and this project was left out. It was talked about 15 years ago. The residents came to me. They really had a problem. And I came to this, talked to John Coakley about it. And he said, really, it's got to be in next year's budget. So the city engineer drew up some stuff to help me, and I put it in the decision package. But I understand you need a program to find private property, but I'd like to see this project go through this year, because these people I should have been told no right away. We got to start a special project fund up, but we didn't do that. So these people are sitting here thinking, well, maybe we can get it on next year's budget. And we did them projects in Summer Lakes, some major ones out there when I was street superintendent. So what I'm asking is to consider starting a new program like this, but to go through with this project, because they've been under the assumption that this was going to happen. And then it was in the decision package, and it wasn't denied immediately. It was denied later. So you guys probably looked at trying to get a program together. Maybe that's why. But I'm asking to get support for this this project and then move forward with looking at our projects.
Okay, my understanding is, though, that this will make that project possible, what you're proposing.
Yes, it would.
Okay, and it would be this coming spring, which is a year, within the next year.
Correct.
Okay. Alderman Ashower.
I agree with Alderman Bevere. These people have waited a long time. They thought they were going to be included in some of the projects that were done. I haven't seen people at the council where it involved two courts like this. I know we've had people come in and complain about sump lines that are running too close to property lines and that type of thing. We don't have many instances that I'm aware of that are this significant. And I don't see any need in waiting. I mean, if we're going to develop a policy, that's fine. But they've been put off plenty. I wouldn't have to live like that. I don't believe it is a problem any of them caused. I think it was just falling through the cracks when the development was done with poor drainage that wasn't checked or engineered properly. And
and it is something that needs to be taken care of, and it's a significant problem. One, we're talking about Zika virus and cables and things like that. I don't see any reason to delay it. If we want to develop a policy, fine. But if there's money in the budget for this, with all the other money we're spending, this doesn't seem like it should be held up, and it is a worthy project.
Okay, thank you, Alderman. Alderman Widener?
Yeah, I guess, first of all, at some point I'd like to develop an ordinance that requires all developers to live on the project that they develop for at least 7 to 10 years. And then I think we would probably see fewer of these kind of instances. My question is one regarding safety. We've heard hints that there's a safety issue with regard to this situation. I just wanted to ask the Deputy Public Works Director if indeed there is a life safety issue with regard to this.
There are exposed cables coming out of two pedestals, I think. One is a ComEd pedestal and the other is other utilities. We've been in touch with ComEd, and late this afternoon we actually had an emergency locate for this location to go out and have all the other utilities located, and an email from ComEd following up saying they're going to replace the pedestal. The gentleman who was our liaison with ComEd was going to follow up with additional information, but I hadn't received that before the meeting, other than they were going to get out there and replace the pedestal.
And then there could be other situations that require this kind of work throughout the city, correct?
Oh, there are definitely other situations, maybe not this exact same as Alderman Ashour said. I mean, part of the criteria for a program would be to, when you start ranking them, does it benefit two property owners, does it benefit six or eight? Well, if it benefits six or eight, it's going to be given greater weight in the ranking of a project. But there are others, and part of developing this program is, are we helping out one property owner? Is that something council wants to do, or does it have to be more than one? There's a variety of things we have to discuss. And ultimately, if you choose to move forward with this project, that's completely within your purview to decide to do that and develop a program. I think a program is important, though, because I'd like to make sure we're treating people equally and consistently throughout the community.
And there could be other properties that are the same or maybe taking on more water than this situation?
There could be, yes.
And they would be at a disadvantage because nobody had promised them that it would be taken care of, correct?
Well, or that they didn't ask either. I mean, I'm not aware of any specifically that are worse than this right now, but there are other people we've said no to in the past.
And drainage patterns, if I'm not mistaken, they kind of change and move around a little bit depending on how the ground settles and how development occurs and things like that. So when you get into drainage issues, there could be a whole lot of things that you're looking at if you don't have a program.
Yes, address. I mean, in this specific instance, there's a variety of things that cause the poor drainage. I mean, there's really active sump pumps out there. Poor Summer Lakes has a lot of clay soil that's compacted, so it doesn't accept the water as well as a lot of the community does. And over the time, people build sheds, they build fences, they do landscaping and things like that, where there's probably some flat grading to start with in those backyards where drainage was okay when it was developed, but then it's over time and decades when people make their improvements in their backyards or try to correct problems in their backyards can contribute to worse drainage.
So what you're, I don't know, it seems like a reasonable practice. What any good business would do would be to kind of inventory the problem to see how many problems they had and then prioritize that inventory to see which one needed the attention based on some criteria that you're going to set up. So it seems appropriate to me that we would, kind of try to get a total as far as what we're looking at so that we know how many we're going to address, how much money in the future the city's going to put towards drainage projects and drainage issues and then address them once we kind of get a better feel for what the reality and what the scope is of all the drainage issues that we might have.
Well, I don't anticipate by this fall that I'd have a survey of all the drainage issues in town. I mean, we're aware of some over the years where people have come to us and we've had to say no to them. And we're aware of this one right now that is under consideration. I don't intend to go out and survey all those and try to evaluate everyone, because I'm not, it's, I don't know that it's possible that people aren't going to respond. There are people that put up with bad drainage just because they're used to doing it over the years. It's been, you know, a decade, and they get used to it and don't complain. Somebody else new moves in and says, well, wait, why am I going to put up with this? And comes to the city and asks. I don't think it's realistic to try to inventory all the drainage problems in town.
Well, it just seems like there's got to be a starting point where you'd have to have an idea of what you're going to address in a given fiscal year and set aside that amount of money to handle it in that fiscal year. And then in the following year, you would do the same thing. But there's got to be some sort of priority to address these issues, and there's probably a given number that we can budget for in each fiscal year. And I think that's kind of going along with what you're suggesting, and is that we set up a program so that we can do it in a cohesive, efficient order.
Yes.
Okay. Thank you.
Alderman Berry.
So now this has been removed or was not recommended for the FY 2018 because there wasn't a city, quote, program. Is it possible to still get it into the decision package?
Yeah.
Okay, but we can recommend it. And so if we recommend this, when would this be able to be done? Would they have to wait until the spring of 2018, or would there be something that could be added into something that could start as soon as this late spring, early summer?
If you include in the budget and approve as part of the budget, then I would say it'd be probably later in the summer, early fall. I mean, just given the amount of workload we have up front here with some of the large projects going on, we still would have to actually have a design and put bid documents together and go out to bid for it.
Okay, and then the other question is the $50,000. Is this something that would be able to handle this project, or do you think it would cost more? This is what you've actually looked at and said this is going to cost approximately this much money.
Yeah, our estimate, our total, the original Harvest Court decision package was for $45,000, and that included engineering, some plats in case some additional easements are necessary, and then the actual construction of the project.
Okay.
That was Christine and I looked at that. And
the other people that you might have talked to over the years, if we set up some kind of program, do you think the $50,000 is a reasonable amount for us to put in this program possibly?
Yeah, my feeling is it'd probably cover most of the projects or most of the people that have come to us over the years. Even some of the more complicated or projects where we could do a lot of good could be done for far less than $50,000. But I think you start getting projects that are larger than $50,000, you really got to start looking at who it's, you know, if it's going to, I don't know that, we'll have to go through this process for a program, but my feeling is that $50,000 is probably in the neighborhood of what you'd want to budget a year if you're going to try to address these problems.
Okay, thank you.
Alderman Bevere, you want to say something?
Yeah, just I know we have another resident in the room tonight too that came forward just recently, but like you said, these guys came forward 15 years ago and they came forward a year ago again. Nobody's really come forward, so it'd be great to get the program going and let people know it's available. But I really feel strong to try to do this year for these residents. And we do have photographs if you want to see them tonight, of the deterioration of their backyards and a little bit of flooding and, you know, the boxes that are getting destroyed. They're underwater. You got ComEd boxes that get underwater constantly there, and that can't be good, you know. I mean, you know, at some point it's got to short out. So I'm still in favor of moving forward with a program, finding areas that we can look forward to and, you know, prioritize them. But I just think that this was done 15 years ago, never got moved forward. I remember talking to the residents at that time. We didn't draw up plans or nothing, but it was a big concern, and I just would like to see this get into this year's budget and then move forward with new people that come in, because really nobody's come in except one other resident. And he just came in after the budget, you know, it was like they did last year. He just came in. So That's my comment.
Okay. Phil, how many properties are impacted by this particular problem? Do you have an idea?
I think it's at least six. I think it might be as many as eight.
Okay, good. All right. Alderman Wilson?
Yeah, I guess my point is tonight you want us to approve, put this on the money into the budget for this specific project. Is that correct?
My recommendation was for a more generic private property drainage project was what using that $50,000 was for. This project could fall under that easily with the program that's developed. I mean, if we've heard discussion, you know, some aldermen have spoken up and said they'd like to see this project go in and then develop a program at the same time, kind of concurrently. Ultimately, whatever you decide, we'll have to make work, I think. So it's, if the decision is to put this project in the budget, then that's what we'll be advancing as the first project, but we'll also be developing a program because I think it makes sense to try to treat, again, look at future projects and be able to help them out too.
Okay, because I'm looking at your recommendations here. You know, will the construction be work done by contractors or public works?
In this case,
that's one of the recommendations.
Yeah. In this case, it would have to be done by contractors. There's no way public works would have the time to do it this year.
Okay, so it would be that. And the rest of the suggestions are met, private property, construction, easements. Do we have all that is taken care of in this particular project, or is that still to be worked out?
That's why we wouldn't be able to build it later in the summer or the fall, even if you gave us a go-ahead to start May 1st. We'd have to get an engineer and a surveyor on board to help research the easements and draw something up and develop bid documents.
Well, then how long would it take us if we were to approve the recommendation to direct staff to prepare and recommend a city private property drainage? If we were to pass that tonight, how long would it take to get that approved and part of the budget, and then we could still put that money in there, but this property would have to meet the same criteria as all future properties would have to meet. That's my only question, is that are we picking something out that might change, and the policy is already established because we've done it here, and I don't know whether that's a precedent-setting thing or if it can be worked out. And I'm all in favor of trying to do everything we can, and if we can get it done this year, fine. My concern is with getting a policy established so that all future people that come with problems will be handled in the same way.
Thank you, Alderman. Alderman Davalos?
Yeah, I've given this project almost as much thought as the budget over the weekend because I'm just putting myself in the place of these folks over there. And so to me, it's the horse before the cart. I mean, can we do this before we have a policy? Because we don't have a policy. So it's going to take a while, I'm assuming, to establish a policy, and the council will vote, and we'll have discussions, and it'll go on probably into the summer and the fall, I guess. And yet, would there possibly be a way to, I mean, this is eight homes. And if Alderman Bevere is correct, and it's been, we did a lot of Summer Lakes projects, but we didn't do this one, it just seems like it's a very unique situation here. I have several flooding areas in Ward 3, which is the ward that I represent, and they're not eight families, but they're serious things. So I think the need for a policy is huge, and I'm definitely in favor of that. I'm just mulling over this idea, can we somehow work on this Harvest Court project at the same time we're working on the policy? And I know it's going to take a while to get, as you've explained, all the easements, all the engineering, get the consultant, get the votes, everything, whatever it is. Because I'd like to see this happen sooner than later. I hate to go all the way to spring of 18, and I know why it's in the decision package, but I'm just wondering if we couldn't do both at the same time somehow.
I will ask our city attorney to weigh in on what his opinion is.
The council could certainly do both at the same time. They can direct staff to start putting together a policy. They can also direct staff to specifically start working on this project if the council feels that this project is important enough to begin right now. Without the necessity of looking at some policy and making sure that this particular project qualifies for a policy. The only concern I have is something that's been raised by some of the other aldermen, Mayor, which is you're setting a precedent now, as the Deputy Public Works Director pointed out, with regard to what you're going to be doing in the future. So if you have a situation where you've started work on this project, then you're developing a policy, and for whatever reason, you're going to have similar residents coming to you in future years that you decide to turn down, they may very well be pointing to this project that was approved before the policy was put in place and saying, but you did it for them. So you may be putting yourself in kind of a trick bag as far as what you're doing in the future. But to answer Alderman Davalos' question, certainly you can do both, and the council can direct staff to start working on a policy at the same time as it's working on the engineering to fix this particular problem.
I think what we have going for us is that it is a significantly large project. It's not some trivial project that somebody's complaining about some drainage by their driveway in the ditch or something. This is a pretty big project. So it would be, I think, difficult to come up with an argument later saying, well, you did that, you didn't do ours, unless that one was bigger. So we're looking at larger scale things. So you're certainly within your purview to do both things tonight, to fund this project and also give direction to move ahead with a policy. Both of which seem like prudent actions to me. So we'll take some more discussion and then we'll ask for a motion. Alderman Ashar?
Alderman Bevere wasn't clear about it, but he had gone through, when he was street superintendent, a process of trying to evaluate locations that they do in-house and solve several of the drainage issues in Summer Lakes without it having to be added to the budget. This one they just weren't capable of doing. The other question that was brought up was about safety. I know that we've had issues with all of the streetlights in Summer Lakes, or in one portion of it, having streetlights that had no breakers. So they're hot-wired into the pedestals. So if there was no way to shut that power off if someone were to damage it, or if there was an open leg, I look at that, if that's still going on and we're aware of it, we should be taking care of the drainage.
Well, at this point, as my understanding is, ComEd's already looking at those pedestals to replace them and to do what's necessary, correct?
Correct.
Okay, so the safety issue is being addressed immediately, independent of what you decide tonight.
Well, the issue with not having the streetlights have a breaker on them is still a concern.
I mean, there's no streetlight in the back of this.
That's a safety issue.
There's not a streetlight back along the transformer things, right? I mean, is there a streetlight in the back?
They go into the pedestals, but they don't have it. There's no way to shut the power off.
No, I understand that, but are the streetlights involved in this particular problem?
That was my question. I don't know if they are. I know they're all fed from the pedestals.
Okay.
And if there's a streetlight on one of the courts, which I'm sure there is, we just have to figure out where it is and where it's fed from and if it's protected properly.
Okay, I think John has a comment. Administrator Coakley?
A couple. When Alderman Bevere was the street superintendent, I know that he was very diligent. The city was very involved in, I believe, getting all of the, I just wanna make sure we're clear, the point Alderman Ashar was bringing up, all of the unfused, unbreakered streetlight cables. Some contractor that was not supervised, when we didn't have inspectors or people watching those projects and built those neighborhoods, contractors that you couldn't trust back then, but we thought we could, and we approved those neighborhoods all over the community, if that resonates with anything, ran those cables willy-nilly through backyards, not in utility easements, and we were very diligent about making sure they were all breakered way back in the late 1990s and early 2000s when Alderman Bevere was a street superintendent. So I think those are all covered. So I don't want people to get concerned about that. He discovered that problem out there and it was taken care of. I don't believe, we're not aware of any, in fact, Public Works Department was checking on this even today, that any of those private utility pedestals, like in your backyard over in Harvest Court Lakeview, would have that same circumstance and they're different arrangements. They are in utility easements. What we had the problem with before is unbreakered cables running through backyards where residents did not know they were there and built their swing sets and sandboxes and pools on top of them. And that was a severe potential hazard back then about 15 years ago. Again, those were addressed. I wanna make a couple other comments on this whole process. Tie a couple of things together, I can't help it, but the process we've been talking about, the evolution of public works the last couple of years, part of the difficulty when we had a different setup, and Fred was a street superintendent, we had a different organization, and going forward, I'm not talking about any one individual, I'm talking about the city and the way the department was operated by necessity. We talk about record keeping and all, what was discussed 15 years ago when somebody significant in that department would leave, some of those things got lost. There weren't records of our work orders and our processes that were maintained. So the next person took over and was doing things a little bit differently. We get all the streets plowed, we have water and sewer flows, everything looks nice on the surface, but some of that back office things, there just aren't people to do that. I think this is probably a really good example of something that we were taking care of 15 years ago and it just wasn't recorded. So the next person came along, didn't know anything about it. Apparently it didn't come up again. It's not an excuse, it's just explanation of how that stuff worked, but that's why we're working so hard to bring Public Works along to the next level. Budget process. The elected officials' input into the budget back in October, staff has identified to me, this is an issue where we're realizing there's a little confusion perhaps about that process. An elected official, just like Alderman Bevere did, Alderman Widener brought up some issues, they get put into they fill out a request to have a general idea that comes forward. It goes to a finance committee meeting, the council votes yes or no to move it along to the next process, and then staff starts working on it a little more technically and makes it into a decision package. All of those and everything else in the budget comes from the departments through November, December, gets to the finance department in January. I don't really get my involvement in the budget until late January. During January and February, the finance director and I have met with the departments, go through all this. I won't go through every day of it because it's boring and we're getting late here. I don't look at the whole budget and the individual decision packages and what we can afford and not until we have all of those revenues and everything in and they have the big picture. And all this year, 18 decision packages were all in there, much more than we've had in past years because of all the things you heard tonight going on and much more. That's the point where I give my recommendations as your city administrator and budget officer, whether or not, in my view, looking at the city, and this is part of the role you have me do, part of my job, it would fit within our budget or not. There's three this year that did not get recommended to go through. That's a recommendation. And there's an explanation of what those mean, and you've all talked about those. I suggested we wait until we have a program and then move ahead. Not that it isn't a worthwhile project. It certainly seems to be. By all indications, I've been out there looking at it with our staff just the other day, and there's a problem out there. But should the city do this or not, that's the question of a policy issue. At the end of the day, it's the council's decision what goes in the budget, when to approve the budget. All of the projects get done. It is not mine. It is not staff's. We give you our technical input, and we've done that. This isn't anywhere near thinking about what we like or don't like. It's about what we see and point those things out. The council has two clear decisions, and of course there's probably myriad others, but the ones before you are either approve the decision package that wasn't recommended but is in the budget book, which would mean that $45,000 is approved in the budget and with the direction then that it would be done during the construction season this summer through fall, would go with that. And that's what I'm hearing from certainly Alderman Bevere is recommending and others. Or the staff recommended alternative is approve the alternate decision package for $50,000 with the direction that staff take, and it's gonna be probably the next 6 months. We've gotta get through the construction season, then take a breath and come up with a project and, program and plans and funding, come back to the council likely in the fall with recommendations where you would approve a program going forward. And then if that program is approved, we're assuming this project would come to the top and then next late March or early April when work can actually commence, assuming the weather is good, then something like this project could be done. There's no guarantee it's this project, but that kind of thing would follow that way. There was some, seemed to be a little confusion. Some aldermen seemed to have right on with what we're looking at. Some we're getting the two decision packages mixed up. We don't normally have this choices at this point in the budget, but that's what staff is recommending and what is already in the budget for tonight. So it seems like two courses of action, but the council could decide whichever you want to do.
Yeah, may I suggest that there are two issues. One, you could make a motion to approve the original package and vote that, and then talk about giving staff direction to prepare the program going forward would be a second motion, and that would accomplish things in the most expeditious fashion in terms of getting this project going. So does anybody want to make that first motion? Alderman Bevere?
I had one comment before the motion. I know you guys said ComEd's coming out and going to resolve safety issues, but I don't know how they can resolve a foot of water around a electrical box that's going to seep in there. They can't stop that. That's a problem. They can bury their wires again, which are going to keep eroding, and that's fine. You know, at least the guys that, you know, the residents' animals can't bite on the cables and stuff. But there still is a safety issue out there. I got a picture. If you want to, I brought 12 pictures tonight. They haven't been brought up. It shows a foot of water around the pedestal. If you want to see them, look at them. There's a safety issue out there. Even though ComEd's coming out, there's still a safety issue. And so that's why I feel this should be done this year and then move on with the program. Thank
you. All right. Looking for a motion. Alderman Goodman?
I would like to make a motion that the City Council direct staff to prepare a recommendation for a city private property drainage assistance program for a future committee of the whole discussion, and to include the draft decision package titled Private Property Drainage Project in the proposed fiscal year 2018 budget.
Second. Second by Alderman Widener. Any additional discussion? Alderman Hoffman, did you have discussion?
I was just going to say I would have liked to have seen the pictures. I don't know if they're on a computer where you put them up on the screen or.
Sure. Alderman Davalos.
Clarification. If we vote yes on this motion, then will we be waiting to execute this project until after the process?
Can no.
We work on, I didn't understand, it wasn't clear to me in the motion.
The original decision package was to put it in the budget and move ahead with it. That's my understanding, is that correct? Not wait for. Right. The first decision package was to put it in this budget coming up, correct? That's the most expeditious way to get it done.
The original decision package was, yes, to put it in this year's budget with the underlying assumption it would be done in the construction year this summer or fall.
Okay.
And that's
so that's
the current
what we're,
motion
that's,
on the floor.
That's what we're going to vote on.
Thank
that's
you.
Not the motion on
Hopefully,
the floor. That's not the motion on
that's
the floor.
That's what I thought.
She made the motion for the alternative one that was proposed by staff in the packet.
Oh.
And I'm asking for a clarification on the alternative motion on what.
You can make us.
Can I? All right. Let's go back for just a moment to your motion so I understand, so everyone understands what your motion was.
My motion is to establish a program. Whether we approve this project as part of the budget or not, I think it's very clear we all want to establish a program. That's the first motion. Then someone can make a second motion. I mean, I'm.
Okay.
The first motion does not preclude anything else, but clearly we need this program. So I've made the motion to do so. Thank you.
I understood. I made the assumption that you were going to do the decision package first. My mistake. I do understand now. Thank you. Okay. This is the motion for the program going forward. Additional comment?
No, we have the pictures.
Oh, the pictures. Swell. Roll through the thing. Yes. Alderman Wilson?
Okay, this is only on the first part of the recommendation. And with the second, we can make a second motion.
Correct.
Then to include the draft decision package.
Yes.
Titled in the proposed 208 budget.
Right, that's okay. What I thought was being proposed originally, my mistake.
Okay.
Yes. Absolutely.
Okay, I'm going to talk as these pictures are going by. Thank you. The back one, if you back it up a little, if you can go backwards, I don't know.
Sorry, I missed it. Just a minute.
But there, okay, there's where the cables are exposed. And he's got to have an air protective fence. No, not on that one. Okay,
those electrical,
further back.
Those are electrical cables?
That's where the fence is getting deteriorated from water sitting there all the time. And you can see how the grass and stuff's not growing. When we get up further, you'll see the cables, like right in here. And when we get to the very end of the slides, you'll see where the water's around the ComEd box. And that's what I really wanted everybody to see. But these are more deterioration pictures, these ones here.
Okay. I think we all accepted that there is a problem.
And I'd like to get to the one with the ComEd box, just so you guys can see it right there. And that sits there for days. And, you know, I mean, if it really gets bad, it gets higher on that box. So no matter what ComEd does, it's not going to...
Unless they raise the boxes.
Yeah, they could raise the all the boxes. If, I don't know if that's what's in the scheme. I don't know what they told you, Phil, but, you know.
Well, at least they're addressing it, hopefully.
Okay, thank you for seeing. And there's one more picture there, and then there's, keep going, there's one, get to the very last slide, and you'll see the, right there. See, that's after a good storm. Thank you.
That's a problem. Okay, Alderman Davalos.
Is there a cost to the motion? Is it $5,000, the difference between the $50,000 and the $45,000 to do the program?
My assumption would be that they're going to bring back the program with a recommendation to have a certain amount put into the budget going forward, right?
Yeah.
So there is no initial cost. There's just direction to staff to work on this. So there will be staff time cost, that's all. All right, everybody on the same page finally? Let's see, we had a motion by Alderman Goodman. Do we have a second?
Yes.
Alderman Widener, okay. No more comments, no more questions. Roll call.
Alderman Berry.
Aye.
Alderman Goodman.
Aye.
Alderman Widener.
Aye.
Alderman Hoffman.
Aye.
Alderman Bevere.
Aye.
Alderman Davalos.
Aye.
Alderman Ashauer.
Aye.
Alderman Wilson.
Aye.
All right. And we need a second motion then. Alderman Bevere.
I'd like to make a motion to accept the project in the decision package, and I'd like to up it to 50,000 from 45. Is that because they were saying it might be 50,000? Is that?
Well, the decision package has 45,000 in it. Does it not?
Harvest Court drainage improvements, I'd like to make a motion to accept that for this year's budget. And I guess they were saying that they wanted to up it to 50,000, but I don't know if we can change that figure in there at this point.
All right, hold on just a second, City Administrator.
Okay, my understanding of the prior motion was you recommended the alternative decision package that includes $50,000 into the budget with the direction to develop the program. So I believe now the motion that I don't want to put words in your mouth, but I think you want to make is to direct staff to do that project this summer. Before the program is developed. Thank you.
It's getting late.
All right, I thought I understood. Now I'm confused again. So we're looking at $95,000 now instead of 50?
No. You've got 50 already put in the budget. No. You just didn't direct anybody to do the project this year.
That's what I thought.
Point of clarification?
I'll amend the motion.
I specifically asked if there was a monetary impact with the budget, with the motion you made, and the answer was no. So that meant there was no $50,000 in there. That was to develop a program.
The program wouldn't be approved to spend the $50,000 until we bring back the recommendation in the fall. The decision package would put the $50,000 that you just approved, puts $50,000 in the budget, contingent spending on it. The spending is contingent on developing the program, the council approving it in the fall.
But let's get the city attorney. Okay. We might as well get him involved.
Okay. I haven't spoken in a few minutes. As I understand it, the first motion.
Listen now.
To establish a program. You're directing staff to come back to you with some type of program, whatever that may be. The second motion is to specifically approve the work for Harvest Court at an amount of whatever the alderman wants to put in his motion. If Alderman Bevere wants to recommend that this work be done at $50,000, that's his motion. He could have made it $30,000. He could have made it $70,000. He's making a specific motion for the work to be done at a not to exceed cost of $50,000. That's the way I understand this proceeding, irrespective of what may or may not be in the decision package.
All right, so that's your intention, Alderman Bevere?
Okay.
Is that?
Yes.
Okay, all right, does everybody get that? Alderman Wilson?
A question. I see Exhibit A and Exhibit B in our folder. Or am I out of date here? At B is the one that says private property drainage project, and that's the one that we just approved. The budget amount there is $50,000. The other one, A, is for the Harvest Court drainage improvements. So that's a separate. We're not voting on that. That's $45,000.
Except that Alderman Rivera wants to up it to 50. So he's taking that motion and changing the amount from 45 to 50.
Well, then we're changing the title, Private Property Drainage Project. Are we? Is that A or B? That's Exhibit B, is it not?
Yeah, we did it. That's where I got confused initially. I was expecting the first one first, and the second one got first. So,
okay.
Does the clerk understand what we're doing?
No.
Ah. Well, we're gonna have to get some kind of clarification before we get done here.
Well, trying to pigeonhole this into the decision package rather than just listening to what.
All right. Explication or question?
Well, it.
Oh, are you calling?
Yeah. Oh. Alderman Diabolos, I'm sorry.
Okay, so this project is a $45,000 project, as it always was. I'm thinking that the policy, it does not have a dollar amount to it. So we just passed the policy, no dollar amount. We will have a new motion that will be have the $45,000, or I suppose it could be 50. I don't know why you'd raise it, but $45,000 to do the project that was the original. One submitted by Alderman Bevere for the budget.
That's what I thought was going on, but okay. I've been countermanded several times in different directions. But
next motion.
The first motion is to direct staff to develop the policy.
Yeah, we already passed it.
Yes, that's done. Okay, got that? The second motion now is for a money amount for a specific project. And Alderman Bevere wants to change the amount from 45 to 50,000. So the motion is for that project to allocate in the budget $50,000 to address the problem. Correct?
We need a second.
Yeah.
Second.
All right, take your pick of the seconds, clerk. Plenty of volunteers. Motion and a second. Does everyone understand? Are the residents hopeful at this point? Are you following what's going on? Alderman Asher, did you have an additional comment?
My comment is, are we comfortable with the $45,000 as being adequate for that project?
No, it's 50 now.
That's why I'm asking.
Yeah.
The motion on the table is 50.
Right. But he's just asking a question. Clarification.
Yeah, this is clarification. Yeah. The $50,000 included the development of the policy and money for that project was my understanding. Now that's all changed. We don't have any budget for the policy. Is $45,000 adequate for this project?
I'm not anticipating the drafting the policy is going to take anything but staff time. I'm not anticipating
right,
we're going to
I
hire
think we
anybody
already
or pay any money
that.
Off of that. The $50,000 was for a generic project. If the policy would have been program was developed first and potentially you came across something that would benefit 12 properties that would have qualified higher than this one, then $50,000 was just a number that we put in somewhat based on this project, but is a round number for this year until we develop a program.
Yeah, there's no there's no amount with the policy direction at this point. That's what staff is going to come back for with and give that.
No,
us.
I understand that.
I'm
my
sorry.
Question is,
right.
45
is
comfortable
enough.
With the 45,000
right. Right.
to
and
accomplish
he's saying
the
yes.
project.
Yes, he's answering the affirmative. That sounds good. So we're up for $50,000 to do this project. Emily.
Alderman Diabolos.
Aye.
Alderman Aschauer.
Aye.
Alderman Hoffman.
Aye.
Alderman Widener.
Aye.
Alderman Wilson.
Aye.
Alderman Berry.
Aye.
Alderman Goodman.
Aye.
Alderman Bevere.
Aye.
Motion carries. You can go to Two Brothers. We've got more work to do.
Thank you for your
patience. You're welcome. All right. We do have nothing. Oh, wait. Continuation of FY 2018 budget discussion. Does anybody want any additional discussion of the budget tonight? I'm not going to look very carefully. I don't see anyone. Okay, unfinished business, nothing. New business, nothing. We do have the need for a closed session. However, Alderman Berry, please, the citation.
I'd like to make a motion to go into closed session for the purpose of 5 ILCS 120/2, parens C, parens 1, the appointment, employment, compensation, discipline, performance, or dismissal of specific employees of the public body or legal counsel for the public body, including hearing testimony on a complaint lodged against an employee of the public body or against legal counsel for the public body to determine its validity.
Second.
Motion and a second to go into executive session. May I have a roll call, please?
Alderman Berry.
Aye.
Alderman Widener.
Aye.
Alderman Hoffman.
Aye.
Alderman Wilson.
Aye.
Alderman Ashower.
Aye.
Alderman Goodman.
Aye.
Alderman Bevere.
Aye.
Alderman Davalos.
Aye.
Thank you, Emily. Excuse me, we will not be conducting any business after our closed session, so you're free to go. We have a little more work to do. Thank you for your attendance and your patience. You're welcome.